So please tell me if you have any problem in seeing or hearing, because I cannot see any one of you on the screen. So my topic today is role of fertility enhancing surgeries in active practice. So of course there can be so many problems either with the male or with the female, and today it's too vast a subject and we cannot talk of all the surgeries that we can do to promote fertility and to facilitate ART. So I'm going to talk about only the common things which we encounter in our day-to-day infertility practice and how to improve the outcome of ART. So I have selected only a few topics so that I should not take up too much of your time. So first of all, fibroids are the commonest tumors that we encounter, and especially in infertile women. So there are many reasons for infertility. Here you can see I have taken this from Dr. Durga Rao's contribution chapter in Fibroids, the Uterine Leiomyoma textbook. So here there are so many reasons for subfertility, like physically disturbing the cavity or disturbing the uterine peristalsis. Locally, they're disturbing the cytokines and by genetic factors, and a lot of functional changes in the endometrium and the myometrium. So there are so many different kinds of fibroids you can see here. They can be intramural, they can be subserous, they can be multiple, they can be single. So they can be in different locations. And so how do we actually, does every woman, we need to ask ourselves a few questions. Is it that every woman with fibroids and infertility, does she need it to be treated and operated upon? And who needs treatment? And what type of treatment is required? So again, this is Dr. Durga Rao's slide, again from the same textbook. So these are the various slides, studies showing various sizes of intramural fibroids and their reproductive outcomes. So if you look here, you can see less than 3 centimeters are not included in the study. More than 7 centimeters are also excluded from the study. So less than three, usually they don't interfere with fertility, usually, not always. But 4 to 7 centimeter fibroids, they show a significant decrease in clinical pregnancy rates. So they need to be tackled in some way or the other. So now while doing myomectomy surgery to promote fertility, what are the precautions you have to take? Because you need to look at so many factors. So you should see that an intracapsular enucleation, as you can see here, preserving as much of myometrium as possible. Minimum number of incisions, so you can see here, retrieving too many fibroids through the same incision. Very good technique at suturing. Sometimes you need to do the repair in 2 layers, 3 layers. Using minimum electrocautery, you can see we use vasopressin to achieve a bloodless field, and then we use traction and counter traction with the myoma spiral. But suturing, all said and done, suturing has to be perfect, because unless you suture properly, if needed in multiple layers also, you should be able to suture as you do in the open surgery. Only then we will achieve a good scar and a good result. So what if the cavity is open? Is it really dangerous? I mean, can we always avoid opening the cavity? It may not be possible, because if the fibroid is protruding too much into the endometrium and pushing the displacement in the endometrium, sometimes it might be open. Of course, we will try as much as possible not to open the cavity. Why? Because there is a fear that if the cavity is open, the opening becomes through and through, and so the scar will be very weak, and chances of rupture are more. But what does the literature say? Actually, the literature says only 39 cases of myomectomy scar ruptures have been reported so far, and out of those, only 7 of them the cavity has been opened. So whether the cavity is opened or not, the integrity of the scar, it depends more or less on the type of repair that you do. So even if the endometrium is opened, if you do a perfect repair, achieve a perfect hemostasis, the scar is going to be good. So here I am showing you one of our publications, Myomectomy for uterine preservation as well as fertility. So this has been published in the International Journal of Reproduction, Contraception, Obstetrics and Gynecology in 2019. So here you can see we have compared our results with the different authors, and the rates of conception following myomectomy. So after all, when we have done for infertility, we have done some 700-800 myomectomies, and out of those, this many have been done, 157 were done between these years for infertility, and rest of them were done for other symptoms. So here you can see the conception rates anywhere between 38% to 75%, and our conception rates following myomectomy have been 40%. And the classification of myomas is different. I know that Dr. Kage is going to talk on submucous hysteroscopic procedures, but I just wanted to mention that these classifications are very important. Type 0, 1, and 2, and also the step W classification, which takes the many other factors into account, especially when you are dealing with a submucous fibroid. And then also you should remember that we might think that, okay, 2 cm you can do very easily. Resection of submucous myoma depends on your experience. So between 2 and 3, you may think that it is only 1 cm, but the volume increases almost 3 times. You can see here 4.19 the volume. With a 3 cm jumped up to 14 plus, so 3 times. Again here between a 4 cm and a 5 cm, it has become almost double the volume. So the volume keeps increasing, and then so the dissection will be more and more difficult, and then you also, the bleeding may be more and more, and you may not be able to do in a single sitting when it is a very big submucous myoma. So we also have another publication, this one in the Journal of Obstetrics and Gynecology of India. So hysteroscopic resection of submucous fibroid reported by Dr. Swapna. And so in this we have, here again, we have compared with different authors. You can see that conception rates are between 27 minimum to 37 maximum. Our rate has been 32. So more or less in the average conceptions, the rates are lower with the submucous fibroid compared to the intramural fibroids and subserous fibroids. And also you can find here, these are the conception rates here when you take the 0, 1 and 2 types. Now so type 2 had the maximum number of conceptions. And now coming to the endometriosis and fertility issue. So this is another extremely common factor which you see in women with infertility. So to promote the fertility and also to achieve good outcome with your assisted reproductive techniques, you can see that the types of endometriosis, I mean, you have to take many factors into consideration. When you need to operate, and do you really need to operate, or can you treat by medical methods? And if you need to operate, what is the best type of surgery? Is it a partial cystectomy, drainage cystectomy, partial, total cystectomy? Do you need a post-operative suppression again before you take them up for ART? These are all the questions to be addressed. So the types of endometriosis, there are several types, superficial and ovarian endometriosis and deep infiltrating endometriosis. They're all different pathologies also. So here you can see the superficial peritoneal endometriosis, and this is an ovarian endometrioma. You can see the huge endometrioma here, bigger than the uterus, and you see the deep infiltrating endometriosis where the whole rectovaginal septum and the whole back of the uterus has been adherent here with nodules in the rectovaginal septum. So how do you deal with each one of them? When you see a superficial endometriosis, it depends on what you want to treat. We are talking about infertility now. So either you treat the infertility first by, I mean, whatever, ovulation induction or ART. And if they fail, then you can take them up for laparoscopy. Or you can directly go in for a laparoscopy, do the clear up everything and then do. So probably which one is taken up first depends on to which center the woman goes. Suppose she comes to me being a center for endoscopy. Maybe I would like to clear up all the endometriosis before I refer her for ART. And if she goes to an ART center, maybe stage 1 and 2 initially, even other stages, sometimes you may try to do ART first, and if they fail, refer to for laparoscopy. Either way, it is correct, I mean. It depends on your experience. So stage 1 and 2, here you can see the lesions very clearly, all the superficial lesions on the posterior leaf of the broad ligament. And here you can see the ovaries, the endometriomas being adherent, stuck to the back of the uterus, a little higher stage. So how do you go about it? Do you, such cases, do you think really medical treatment will help? Again, you have to ask these questions to yourself. Will medical treatment help? And suppose you do a laparoscopy for diagnostic laparoscopy because the woman hasn't been responding to ovulation induction. So will you just see this and come out? Or will you treat at the same time? Will you clear the disease? So what surgery do you prefer? Do you want to just do a cauterization of the endometriotic spots? Or do you see, you can see here, and most of the times it's on the endometriotic spots are on the uterosacrals or on the ureter. So fulguration may not be easy with electrocautery because you are always worried that you might damage the ureter. So excision is an accepted method. You just cut it with, say, you can see the dark blood coming out. Just remove all these lesions, the peritoneal lesions. And what does evidence say? Medical management in improving pregnancy rates is really, it is not helpful. So laparoscopic ablation or excision improves the pregnancy rate, even in stage 1 and 2. So suppose now coming to the ovarian endometriosis. You find an endometrioma on ultrasound. And what is the choice of treatment for an endometrioma? Suppose it is less than 3 or 4 centimeters. Some people take 3, some people take 4 as cutoff point. So what is your type of management? Do you first try ART or do you want to deal with it, tackle this? So once again, we will look at the evidence, what it says. And before that, we should also realize while clearing an endometrioma by laparoscopy, there are 3 zones, like one zone A is where it is stuck to the back of the uterus or the broad ligament or whatever the ovarian fossa, where it is actually the entry point. So that point is very thin. As you're trying to separate the ovary, you will find that this opens and the dark fluid, it drains out. The next one is you have to find the plane of cleavage between the capsule and the cyst wall inside. So if you just excise a little bit of the cyst wall with scissors, you'll be easily able to find out the plane. And then when cleavage occurs at the level of the ovarian hilum, at the hilum there are a lot of adhesions, and if you just keep pulling it out and separating, what happens is there is going to be a lot of bleeding there. So near the hilum, you may have to use some electric current. So here you can see this is the zone A. And now we are trying to open up and try to find out the, you can see once you find this zone B, which is a clear zone between the cyst wall and the ovarian cortex, because if you peel off the whole cortex, she's going to lose the ovarian tissue. So you just try to peel off and use the cautery only at the place of hilum, where there's a lot of bleeding. Here you can see this cyst wall is very thick and this is a much bigger cyst, more chronic. And here you can see the cortex is so thin. If you peel off this entire cyst, you will lose most of the ovarian cortex and her ovarian reserve is going to cut down, the number of eggs is going to come down. So remove as much as you can, then cauterize the rest of the thing and then leave it like that. So partial cystectomy, you may be forced to do in some of the cases. So what does the evidence say once again? These are all evidences have been taken from FOXI, good clinical practice recommendations on endometriosis. So the excision of endometrioma, that is cystectomy, is recommended. So cystectomy is recommended rather than just opening, draining and coming out. That doesn't serve any purpose because it's going to form once again. So do a cystectomy. That will increase either a spontaneous pregnancy rate or your outcome of ART. And now coming to the third entity, that is a deep infiltrating endometriosis. You can see here, there is no pouch. The whole rectum is pulled up and adherent here, and you can see a lot of adenomyosis also here. So is it, I mean, really worthwhile clearing all this deep infiltrating endometriosis before you resort to ART? Because this patient, mostly she will need an ART only. So you can see the rectum being pulled up here and totally adherent there. There is a nodule there. in the rectovaginal septum. So according, I feel that even deep infiltrating endometriosis, unless you clear the pouch of Douglas and create a space there and release the ovaries, there is no way you can, mostly there are associated endometriomas also. So unless you clear the whole thing, there is no place for, I mean, even for egg retrieval or to do an IVF. So the, what does the, but evidence says the effectiveness of surgical removal of deeply infiltrating endometriosis in women undergoing ART with regards of pregnancy outcome is debatable. So that's what the evidence says. So you can try ART even without clearing a deep infiltrating endometriosis if the, your ovaries are accessible. And for how about stage 3 and stage 4 endometriosis? What is your choice of treatment? Would you like to do ART first, ovulation induction, or would you like to do surgery first? And after surgery again, such cases stage 3, stage 4. So I would definitely like to clear this up before referring her for ART, taking her up. Because number one, with such big endometriomas and such additions, it's not possible to get the eggs, enough number of eggs, and also that is one point, and the accessibility of the ovaries is the other. And also this the chocolate fluid might be toxic. When you aspirate that, you may not get a good quality egg. And ovulation induction also is not possible with huge this. And also another thing, when you're retrieving eggs in the presence of chocolate cysts, because it's a chronic inflammatory process, the whole endometriosis. So if it gets infected, sometimes we see that after clearance of severe endometriosis, the inflammation can flare up and they might develop ovarian abscess. So egg retrieval can produce an infection, and again, if we end up with an ovarian abscess, that's going to be a terrible complication, very difficult to deal with. So better, I for one would prefer to clear this up and then only take up for ART. So evidence also says that the operative laparoscopy is indicated in stage 3 and stage 4 compared to expected management to increase the spontaneous pregnancy rate, they are saying. But I feel stage 3 and 4, what happens is, if you keep on inducing ovulation, if you just leave to nature, if they don't conceive, then again, with each passing month, the endometriosis is going to increase again and again. So best thing is to do an IVF immediately and achieve a pregnancy. So suppose you have bilateral cysts. In that case, the three-step technique can be followed: initial drainage, followed by a GnRH analog, followed by a second surgery where you can totally clear the disease, because the extensiveness of surgery can be reduced by 50%. So we had a similar case here. Here, this girl, she was a recently married. Her husband was a cardiologist doing cardiology, PG in Ames. So you can see this is extending almost up to the liver. This was a huge, 15 centimeters in diameter. So in the initial first sitting, we didn't plan to remove the whole thing because we will be removing most of the ovarian substance. So we just drained the thing and came out and then reduced the size of the cyst and removed the cyst wall for biopsy and cyst wall as much as possible. And then we went in for the second surgery. We gave her GnRH analog and then we went in for the second surgery. Here you can see the size of the cyst is much less and we could clear up most of the endometriosis. And finally, we referred her for IVF, and IVF was successful in the first attempt, she delivered. But unfortunately, we told her that she needs a long-term suppression before she has another IVF. But then she never came back, and then recently she came back with another big cyst again, because without suppression, the endometriosis is going to grow back again. So this is all the history, only the same thing, GnRH analog and then IVF. In the second look surgery, so she delivered a baby by C-section. So actually, this is another publication in which our center was also included about endometriosis. This has been by Dr. Pratibha from GE Maternity Hospital, Savita from Swapna Healthcare, and Dr. Anuradha from Anu Infertility. So collected cases from all the three centers and then analyzed them. and how we proceeded and how did they conceive. So here you can see among all these statistics, in GMH they had a mostly ovulation induction, they conceived, because the other 4 centimeters again before IVF surgery is recommended, and recurrent endometriosis surgery is not at all recommended. So the next common thing is the Mullerian anomalies and fertile tissues. There are so many types of classifications as you can see here, but here HPESG classification is the most popular because it gives us a very comprehensive classification, uterine, the cervical and the vaginal anomalies, everything together. There can be about, we have seen in my 40 years practice, I have seen so many varieties. They can exist in 100 different combinations and permutations. So what happens? Suppose you leave it alone, what will happen? So here again, there is this, you can, if you see this table, you can make out that the overall unification defects, if you look at them, conception rate is definitely low. First trimester, second, third, preterm labor, malpresentations, they're all increased when they conceive with the uterine anomaly. So you need to clear the uterine anomaly, which is interfering with pregnancy or a continuation of pregnancy, you have to do that. So there are so many anomalies like imperfect hymen, of course, you have to open. Because even for you to do ART, you need to cut the hymen and go inside. And vaginal agencies, you have to create an artificial vagina. Cervical agencies, I mean, you do whatever you can, at least find the opening. Vaginal septums, which are blocking the vagina, you will have to remove them before doing the ART. A T-shaped uterus, a lateral metroplasty will help. Uterine septum, of course, most of the septa have to be excised. And non-communicating horns, because they create a lot of problem with the collection of blood inside them and producing endometrial and producing chocolate cysts and all. And even Mullerian hypoplasia and agenesis, nowadays we have the uterine transplantation, giving hope to those women. So how there are so many types of anomalies, the vaginal, the cervical, etc. So vaginal septum here, I just wanted to show you on that. This you can see, there is a big septate uterus, wide uterine cavity, you can see here, wide uterine fundus. So there has been a huge septum inside the uterus. Here if you can see, there is a vaginal septum also. So unless you, this septum has been very thick and it was obstructing, that's the uterine septum. And this is the vaginal septum here. You can see we are excising the vaginal septum, a longitudinal vaginal. There is no place even to have intercourse there. So we had to excise the entire septum to expose the cervix and then go inside the cervix and then do the hysteroscopic dissection of the septum. So the Roberts uterus, it's a rare abnormality. Asymmetric septate uterus, if you can, only a few cases have been reported. We also had a few cases. Here you can see, this is a oblique septum inside the uterine cavity. And here you can see, this whole column is before surgery, where this is a thick septum. This is the main cavity, this is the non-communicating cavity. Different views. Then this is immediately after the repair where you break the septum. This is totally after you cut the septum after the second sitting. So treatment can be done either by laparotomy or by hysteroscopy or by laparoscopic resection. The blind cavity can always be resected. Here again, this is another one of our cases where here you can see this tube and ovary are absent because they have removed it previously. And this is the blind horn, which we have been removing, blind, non-communicating, but functioning. So she developed basically a chocolate cyst in the ovary because of this blind horn. And they did a sapping oophorectomy, but then they produced this defect there. And she was menstruating into the peritoneal cavity through that fistula. She came with a fistula to us. So we had to do a laparoscopy. We had to clear all the additions. She came back with very severe pain. So we had to, I call this a fertility promoting surgery because we could repair the defect where there was a fistula. With that fistula, she could have landed up in any complication so far. So which method is superior? Both can be done, but laparoscopy, you can do a good repair. And then coming to isthmosis, nowadays you are finding lot of ischemoceles where there is a defect in the previous caesarean scar. Yes, you can see the scar. Can you see? This is all. This is a very pale area. Here you can see on laparoscopy transillumination, the light showing there. So just open up the UV fold, you find that ischemocele there, the defect there. You open the defect and then you have to suture it nicely to produce a nice good scar, because what will happen if you just leave it? When you want to do an ART, it may, number one, it may fail to implant. Number two, it will produce an adherent, it may produce a scarectopic, or it can produce a placenta accreta, producing a severe complication, life-threatening complication later on. So excise the entire scar tissue and then laparoscopic repair of the whole thing. So this lady had a very good outcome. You can see here, she conceived with IVF. Then she had a normal course of pregnancy with C-section. And here you can see the scar integrity. The lower segment is very thick. This is the area of the scar where we have repaired. And the scar area was good. And tubal pathologies, I just have a few more slides. I think I can carry on. Yeah? Hello?
Yes, okay. Madam, you can continue.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am, you can continue, ma'am.
Okay. So tubal pathologies, again, you can have a hydrosalpinx, collection of fluid inside the tube. The tube can be blocked either at its origin with the uterus proximal, or it can be blocked at the fimbriel and a distal occlusion, or there can be peritubal lesions which damage the relationship between the, damage the ovum pickup mechanism. So here you see the hydrosalpinx in the, you can see this on ultrasound, and you can see on the laparoscopy also, you can see huge bilateral hydrosalpinges. So usually, why is it a problem when you want to even to do an ART? For spontaneous pregnancy also, of course, hydrosalpinx is an end-stage tubal disease. So the cilia are all lost. The peristalsis of the tube is lost. It's a pathological tube. And then also, even if you do an IVF and put the embryo there, if it is a communicating hydrosalpinx, the fluid will go back into the uterine cavity. It may wash off the embryo and your results will be poor. So we have to deal with them before you do the ART. So which type of surgery would you like to do? You do a salpingostomy and then leave it open, or do you do a salpingectomy? So I would definitely say salpingectomy, because salpingostomy, even if you put an incision, we have seen even in an ectopic, when you do a salpingostomy, tube heals and then it closes and again the fluid will collect. Or in after you do an ectopic, tube will heal and it can produce a spontaneous pregnancy also. So salpingectomy is better where possible. Where it's not possible, at least you block the tubes at the coronal area so that the fluid doesn't get back into the uterine cavity. So is medical treatment useful? It's not useful, but it's not going to affect the hydrosalpinx in any way. And surgical, of course, mostly salpingectomy or blocking the tube. And a distal tubal occlusion, do we do a microsurgery? Do we do a, create a new opening, doing a neosalpingostomy? We do a salpingolysis, you can see here, it's all stuck. So by creating a, by draining all the fluid and then creating a new opening, here you can see we are trying to open up the tube and then drain all the fluid. And then here you can see the fimbria pouting here. So when you do a terminal this thing, the fimbria will come out. Fimbria have come out. But still, how about the results? Are they good? So mostly they may not be good because already the whole mechanism is gone. So I would rather prefer blocking the tubes and an ART rather than doing all these tubal repair surgeries. But one point is, if it works out, then it will be a permanent thing and they can have further children also. And then salpingoscopy to visualize the inner side of the tube. So this we have already addressed. And coming to the pelvic adhesions, so many types of adhesions. They can be flimsy, they can be very thick, binding down the uterus. So do we always need to clear these additions before we can do ART. Excuse me, 1 minute. Let me have some. I would say better to clear the additions, because if they disturb, you can say the tubo-ovarian alignment, they disturb the tubal peristalsis, and for your ovum pickup also, it may be very difficult to get the ovaries, to access the ovaries if all those additions are there. So why do additions form at all? It may be an end result of a PID, it may be an endometriosis, it may be a previous surgery. So to release all those additions and then reestablish the actual normal anatomy, it will help a lot really. So PID can produce so many things like a T-vomas and Asherman syndrome inside the uterus, the pelvic additions, the pyosappings. So all these need to be dealt with before you do the ART. So how do you, but we always know, even though you release the additions, they may reform again. So how do you prevent the re-addition formation? It's by a good surgical technique, very gentle handling of tissues, achieving a very good hemostasis, filling the pelvis at the end of the surgery with saline, or sometimes using addition barriers if it's a limited area. And then adenomyosis, again, it can produce infertility, or even if you achieve a pregnancy with ART, it may produce a pregnancy loss. So the mechanisms, there are so many mechanisms, by the junctional zone, by interfering with uterine peristalsis, by producing the biochemical changes, functional changes, and also the 3D transvaginal ultrasound can diagnose, make an excellent diagnosis, and where you cannot do that, maybe an MRI also can do that, can give you the diagnosis. So on hysteroscopy also, you find a lot of endometrial defects and cystic areas and unnatural vascularity, even on hysteroscopy. So once again here, an adenomyomectomy, when do you want to do? It is an extremely difficult surgery when it's a localized adenomyoma, and when it is, you feel that is extending into the subendometrial area and blocking the thing. Here you can see, it's very difficult because it is, there is no definition, no capsule. And for us to isolate that, the uterine walls again, to bring them together is so difficult. It's not like a fibroid surgery where you can get the plane very easily. So medical treatment, more or less, it doesn't work out much. But nowadays with the dynoges, to some extent, it can give you a little reduction in the size of adenomyoma. Then tuberculosis, once again, can produce a lot of problems. You can see this is the Hugh Curtis syndrome, where there are additions under the subhepatic additions there, and then also they have a lot of issues with fallopian tubes, ovaries, and then intrauterine synecia and all that. And other adnexal cell masses, PCOS, we all know. So when do we do, when the PCOS is resistant to ovulation induction, not responding to ovulation induction, or where the AMH is very high and the capsule is very thick. And you all know the technique, the rule of force. So don't use too much of electricity, don't do too many punctures and all that. So borderline ovarian tumors, nowadays the preferred treatment is to preserve the fertility and then remove only the affected adnexa, leaving the other adnexa intact when they want to have children. So surgical management, often you have to do fertility sparing approaches. And once again, we found in several cases, even during infertility management or during early pregnancy, we found adnexal torsions. Because after ovulation induction, the ovary becomes sometimes multiple cysts and then becomes heavy, and then it can have a torsion. So if you you can always do a conservative surgery, and you can always untwist the thing, and even though it is looking so black and dark like that, just by untwisting you can see that the color returns. You wait for 5 or 10 minutes, meanwhile you check the other things, and you can find that surprisingly, see here, the tube has already turned pink, and there is a cyst in the ovary which has been producing this torsion. So we have removed that cyst, did a cystectomy, and then we could conserve both the ovary as well as the tube. So egg cell torsion, again, that is another conservative this thing for you. So thank you so much. I think I have covered more or less, I mean, whatever I could cover in this time given to me. Thanks a lot for giving me this opportunity. I'm sorry that I am not able to come and sit among you there due to several reasons. And I enjoyed this session, even though I cannot see any one of you. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you so much, Dr. Savita Madam. That was a very informative and elaborative lecture.
Any questions from the audience? Madam is online still. Any questions from the audience, please? Madam, can we take up some questions, ma'am?
Sure, absolutely.
So I think there are no questions, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you from...
Madam, cutoff size for hysteroscopic removal of fibroids, can we do in two sittings or not? What precautions while doing hysteroscopic myomectomy?
Actually, cutoff size depends on your what expertise you have and what equipment you have. Because for a beginner, it may be 1 or 2 centimeters. For a person who is very well experienced, 5 centimeters also we can do. Yes, we can do in two settings always, and when it is a big, very big submucous myoma, we always counsel the patient that we may have to do in two settings because you may have to stop inadvertently in between when you are doing the procedure. When the deficit, as you all know, the fluid deficit, the main worry for us is one is bleeding, the number two is the TURP syndrome, because even though nowadays we are using not glycine but saline and bipolar electrodes, but still there can be a fluid overload and they can develop a pulmonary edema, if not the TURP syndrome. So once the fluid deficit exceeds a certain limit, you have to stop the procedure. So then when we stop the procedure, just achieve hemostasis and tell them that maybe after another month or two, you can do the reset the remaining submucous myoma. You can do in two sittings, yes.
Thank you, ma'am.
And the center where I have attended in the USA, I have seen them doing the hysteroscopic resection in 4-5 sittings. Even very big ones, they did only hysteroscopic resection and in many sittings.
Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, I have a question. If there is a rudimentary horn, ma'am, once we excise it, do we have to suture it always, and or can we just leave it, cauterize and leave it? Because as you said, there's a chance of formation of fistula and leakage of blood into the cavity. So do we always have to suture it, or just cauterize
it? I'm not able to keep it. Not clear for me. Can't hear properly. Can you repeat the question for me? You coordinators can repeat the question.
Resection of uterus. Resection of your rudimentary horn, ma'am.
Yeah, resection, yes.
Yeah. Do we have to suture it always, or just cauterize, coagulate and leave it? Because you said there is a chance of formation of fistula.
What I showed you was something different. You are talking about a rudimentary horn. I was talking about a oblique uterine septum where one part was non-communicating. So this is a rudimentary horn where there is a very small attachment with the main uterus. Yes, you can just leave it if you don't need to get into the myometrium. So it depends on where exactly the rudimentary horn is. Whereas if it is something where what I have shown you, that was a Roberts uterus where there was a non-communicating part of the uterine this thing, already formed a fistula. So we selected to do a laparoscopic excision and then suture, giving her a firm good scar there because already it was middle width.
Thank you, ma'am.
If you go up in the myometrium and if there is a defect in the myometrium, you have to suture always, yes. Otherwise, they will either get a rupture of the scar during pregnancy or a corneal ectopic or whatever. There can be a lot of problems.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you on behalf of Voices Fertility also. We thank you personally, for taking out of your time from your busy and hectic schedule. Would have been much more interactive if you were physical here, ma'am. Thank you.
Next time. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you very much for the introduction. The reason why we thought of actually speaking about IVF and its journey and the advancements that have been coming with this field is because, frankly, not a lot of us are aware of where this field is taking us. Obs and gynae obstetric is from time immemorial that, like, you know, this field has been there. But when we are really looking at reproductive medicine, we're only talking about 4 decades of it. But in these 4 decades, there's been a huge jump in terms of what we are able to achieve. So the first birth, as we all know, was in 1978 with Louis Brown. And when you look at how she was conceived, it was basically an egg pickup that was done through laparoscopy. One embryo, 8-cell embryo, put back in a fresh transfer, and then, you know, she was born. Since then, there has been a huge journey. But what we always have to remember is that there are certain guidelines through which we have to work. And we should never forget that even if it is a fertility patient, we have to look at the basics first. And when we are talking about fertility practice, every aspect of that couple is important to us. We have to pay special attention to the age of the woman, particularly if she's more than 35, what are the issues that she's going to be coming with? How do we address them before we actually start our fertility treatments? Does she have any medical problems? Does she have any surgical problems that have to be addressed before she conceives? And obviously, in today's world, obesity and the lifestyles that we have, how do we correct that? How do we change that? It is not difficult for us to get a BMI of a 42-year-old woman pregnant. That's fine. But what happens is after she comes to you, that's when the trouble begins. So we, just because we are fertility specialists, we can't say, fine, you're 40, doesn't matter, we'll get you pregnant. We have to think about the fact that our goal together is for the mother as well as the baby to go home safe. So these are the addresses that we actually think about before we even start fertility treatment. And again, looking at how the society is nowadays, in terms of all the lifestyle factors that are affecting us, we have to take care that we give them the right advice when it comes to smoking, when it comes to recreational drugs, or even alcohol and binging. This is where preconceptional counseling still has a mainstay in terms of management of an infertile couple. Now, as we are talking about advances, we just want you to be aware as to where we are in terms of reaching our goals for an infertile couple to get pregnant. Now, this was a paper which was extensive, and the most important aspect of this paper, which I thought would be important, is for us, but this is for women who are more than 35 years old. And the reason why I picked up this paper for us to understand is getting a woman pregnant who's less than 35 is a pretty easy effort. Our skill comes in getting a woman who's more than 35 pregnant. But then what are the challenges and what are the parameters that would enable a couple to conceive once they cross 35? If you can see, if you have 5 embryos put back, the chances of that woman conceiving is 40%. We are talking about embryos, we are not talking about oocytes. So if I have 5 embryos, there's a 40% chance that that woman will conceive and go home with a child. And if you have 10 embryos, there's a 70% chance that that woman will go home with a baby. So looking at the number of embryos, what we have realized is there is still a long way to go for us to reach that level of efficiency where we can get a woman pregnant with just 2 or 3 embryos. We are still stuck at this number. Now, this is where we started off. Now, looking at where we are, what is it that we are expecting in terms of advances when it comes to ART? Now, let us look at the pharmacology first, because when it comes to IVF, more than the protocols, it is the drugs that actually enable us to create the oocytes, develop the oocytes and extract them. So when we are talking about the advancement when it comes to pharmacology, what is actually very disturbing for a woman, the first thing about an IVF is she has to have injections every day. For her, that is the most, you know, troublesome aspect. Even egg retrieval is okay for her because we are giving her anesthesia. But getting injections, even though they are subcutaneous, every day, 3 or 4 injections is the most troublesome and the most disturbing aspect. And this is one thing which actually makes a woman delay her fertility treatment. So when we are really looking at advancements, the first thing that we wanted to do is to see whether we can reduce that burden. And one of the injections that is going to very soon come into the market is corifolitropin alpha, which actually enables us to give one injection and that one will last you for a week. Which means that you'll only need another 3 to 4 days more of injections and then she'll be done with her stimulation. So this is really going to enable women to actually reduce that burden. We are also looking at other developments here. When we are talking about, Recagon or even Gonalef, these are the recombinant FSH. But how are these recombinant FSH developed? They're coming from the hamster cell lines, which again means that is coming from a different species, which again has some immunogenicity issues and potential. So what the science and research has done is to bring about different kinds of hormones, which are recombinant, but are coming from the human cell line, which will make them more effective, less immunogenic, and therefore much more effective. We are also looking at different kinds of these hormones which are going to reduce the dosage that is going to be given as well as make the stimulation much shorter. We are also looking at making them cheaper because that's the second burden that we have, is the finances that are associated with the fertility treatments, particularly IVF. So here we are looking at going for biosimilars, which means that these hormones are going to be produced completely in the factory setting. We are not going to require any kind of cell lines, but they'll have the same kind of efficiency and efficacy, which then drastically reduces your cost. Now there's a lot of research going on in this. There are a lot of studies also that are slowly being published about these biosimilars, but they still haven't replaced our traditional recombinant injections so far. Now kisspeptin, this is a hormone that is being produced by our hypothalamus and an extremely efficient and effective hormone. Now, if this comes into our pharmacy to help IVF patients, we are going to completely eliminate OHSS. We have come a long way actually in reducing our complications of OHSS by using agonist as a trigger. But if we have kisspeptin, that is going to completely eliminate the concept of OHSS. Not only that, it will also reduce the number of immature oocytes that we sometimes tend to have when we are doing oocyte recovery, and also increase the number of more M2 oocytes. So this is also something that is there, but only being used in some research setting and in some centers. But again, this is something that we are going to be looking forward to in the next 5 years. Now that was as far as drugs are concerned. But there has been a great sea change when we're talking about stimulation protocols as well, when we're talking about IVF. It is no longer traditional agonist and antagonist. You get your period, then we start the treatment. No longer that. In fact, we are at that stage where we can start stimulation at any part of her menstrual cycle. We can do a random start at any point. And that is something which is very, very important for people who need fertility preservation, particularly the women who are diagnosed with malignancy and need to actually conserve their and preserve their oocytes before they go for any kind of gonadotoxic therapies. Now, random start, but when we are talking about premature ovarian insufficiency or people who have extremely poor ovarian reserves, for them, dual stimulation has become an extremely good way for us to improve the chances of pregnancy. Because going back to the previous slide, we said we actually need somewhere between 5 to 10 embryos for them to reach a pregnancy beyond 40%. For us to reach that number, I need more oocytes. For somebody who doesn't have enough oocytes, what do we do to manage that? Dual stimulation. Now, those were the things that we spoke about in terms of different kinds of stimulations and medications. What about the lab? When we are talking about what is going on in the lab, again, there has been a huge change in how things are actually working. We have moved from big, huge AHU boxes to something which is very slim and tender, and you know, just even in a normal room, you can actually have a Koda tower that is going to give you the more purified air that is required for a lab. We have also had, see, when you're talking about sperm, it's easy for us to actually evaluate a sperm because it's produced outside and you know, you have different ways of assessing it. But when it comes to the oocyte, unfortunately, we don't have a great deal of understanding as to how an oocyte is unless an embryo is created. But Polescope here has helped us evaluate and categorize an oocyte, and this enables us to actually vitrify only the oocytes which have good viability. Now, again, when we are talking about sperm, there are a lot of options that we have in terms of sperm selections. When you have things in great numbers, unlike in oocytes, when sperms are there in so many thousands and millions, how do you pick out that one particular sperm that is going to give you that embryo that can create a viable pregnancy? Towards that, a lot of work has gone on, and again, as you see, IMSI, which actually helps you to evaluate a sperm at 6,000 magnification, would actually tell you all the ultrastructure of the sperm as well. Now, though this has been there, unfortunately, it has not replaced a good embryologist. Because what happens even with IMSI, even though you're able to pick that one particular sperm, is we have not noticed a great change in terms of live births. The one aspect that it has made a difference in is it has reduced miscarriages. But live births have not increased by the use of IMSI. What about other things? Because IMSI is extremely expensive and very, you know, labor-borne. What about other options that we have? We have something which, in which we use the concept of hyaluronic acid binding. And here, what actually we do is the sperm, which is surrounding the oocyte, has a connection to the cumulus cells. And that aspect of things are actually utilized in something which is called as a pixie dish. And in here, because of the hyaluronic acid, we have all the sperms which are actually got the least amount of DNA fragmentation to come and you know, attach themselves to this hyaluronic acid. And then we pick up those sperms to inject into the oocyte. Again, has it really, you know, changed or replaced an embryologist? Again, not yet. What about MAX, which is the magnetic activated cell sorting? Here as well, the concept is extremely important and very simple, and that is when we use annexin beads, what these annexin beads do is they actually go and attach themselves to these sperms which have a lot of DNA fragmentation. So what they do is the machine actually holds back all the sperms which have got a lot of DNA fragmentation, and only the healthy sperms are then evaluated through the system. And because of this, we have much more healthier sperm. Therefore, your DNA fragmentation is lower, the sperm vitality is better, and fertilization rates and the embryo quality is better as well. Now, what about other things? Frankly, microfluidics is where OSS is at this point. Most of our consultants seem to find this extremely useful, and it helped them in terms of improving their fertilization rates as well as embryo quality. And this is something even the embryologists seem to think has made a lot of difference in terms of sperm selection. So whenever we have somebody who's had prior poor fertilization or even poor embryo quality, then you know, microfluidics is something that we seem to find a lot of difference in terms of the quality. And this, the concept is very simple. Again, this is the flow electrophoresis that is being used, and this helps channelize the sperms which have the least amount of DNA fragmentation to be used. So what is the next advantage? Now here, you know, earlier about 15, 20 years ago, we said Klinefelter, fine, you need donor sperms. But that is not the situation now. You know, anybody can go ahead and use donor egg or donor sperm and get a woman pregnant. The technology should be such that we try and get a couple to have their own genetic child. So even in people who have chromosomal problems like this, microtesa actually helps us in evaluating and actually extracting the few sperms that they have. In micro teaser, the surgeon with a extremely good microscope is able to look at where you have the tissue that is more likely to be healthy and have spermatogenesis. We actually tease out that particular tissue, tease the sperms from there. And here, imagine we are not talking about thousands. Forget about millions. We're not even talking about thousands. Here, we are talking about only a few sperms. So what can we do to actually utilize these sperms? We have devices now in which single sperms can be frozen. And that's the vitrification device. And this is something that has been routinely used for the last 2-3 years in OSIS, wherein even men with very few sperms, we are able to give them their own genetic child by actually utilizing devices like this. In fact, this is something that we had approached a Japanese company, if I'm not mistaken, Israel. So because the first paper came from them. So it took us at least 6 months to actually organize this device because nobody else was using it in India. We actually went behind them, waited till they shipped us those. And after OSIS started using it, that's when the company actually brought it to India. Now, there's a lot of talk and a lot of hype about the adjuvants and the add-ons that we sometimes use in fertility. That is because we want to ensure that we have the best success rate. So what is it that we can do to help implantation, to help the embryo quality, to help the oocytes and the sperm, whether it works or not, we are very ready to use it because they're spending so much money in an IVF cycle, we say we have to give them the best. So whether it works or not, let's just put them on a list of medications. Whenever you see a woman who've conceived with the IVF, I'm sure she carries pages and pages of prescriptions with her, a whole huge list. And when they go to the obstetrician, they don't know which one to stop, which one to, continue. So let's look at some of the things that have been used. Now, growth hormone. Now, this sometimes actually, when you speak to anybody outside India, when you speak to people in the Europe or America, they're very scared about using things which have not been actually validated, gone through RCTs, gone through their trials, and then only then, if it's shown to be of benefit, it is brought into the pharmacy, but not in India. Growth hormone is actually used, stroke abused a lot. But in which group is growth hormone specifically utilized? Well, it is for the poor responders. It is basically for the unexpected poor responders, which means that they are young and they have good reserve, but when we are doing the stimulation, they don't end up having a good number of oocytes. So for the unexpected poor responders, for the women who are more than 37, 38, these are the two indications that have actually been proven for growth hormone. But another indication which we have found useful is when you have the resistant PCOS in which you have to go for prolonged stimulation and huge doses of medication and ultimately they end up with OHSS, in those people, adding growth hormone to their stimulation regime actually shortens their stimulation, makes your gonadotropins much more effective. And we have also noticed a lot of change in terms of the quality of the oocyte as well as the embryo quality in this group of women. What about UltraCoQ? Well, a lot of studies have been done, and in fact, of all the antioxidants, I think there are three which actually make sense to us. Right now, it is CoQ, it is melatonin, and the third, vitamin D. These are the three antioxidants that actually make a difference to a woman in terms of improving her oocyte quality. And a lot of studies have shown that the oocytes, the fertilization rates, the number of high quality embryos are better when we give them these antioxidants. And more important, the cancellation rates are lower and the number of embryos available are also more. DHEA, again, another abused drug. But frankly, to give it credit, it does have a role to play, at least in the poor responders, particularly if you give it to them for at least 2 or 3 months prior to their IVF stimulation, wherein it makes a difference in terms of the oocyte quality. What actually it makes a difference in, it is said, is that it reduces your aneuploidy rates. So the miscarriages are lower in these older women when DHEA is being used. What about etosiban? Now, etosiban is a drug that the obstetricians like because it is one of the things that you use for reducing your preterm labor. But frankly, we have found a use for it in fertility as well, wherein, we have noticed that when a uterus has a lot of contractions during or around the time of implantation, your pregnancy rates are reduced. So to help in, you know, sort of reducing the uterine contraction so that there is no expulsion of the embryo, etosepam is given. In fact, there's a lot of research that is going on wherein we are looking at an oral substitute for etosepam. And that would also reduce the burden of injectables as well as prolonged administration. And an oral tablet would probably do the trick for us. Now, glue, embryo glue. This again, you know, just the word makes a woman very hopeful that definitely the embryo is going to stick. Yes, there has been shown advantages with embryo glue in women, and in fact in our study it showed that in women with recurrent implantation failures, we have actually made sure that the implantation is much better by the use of glue. And also what is more important is the miscarriages rates are also lower by the use of embryo glue. Now this one concept of chronic endometritis has taken hold in the last 3 or 4 years, wherein this has found to be one of the aspects which was not actually thought of before as being a cause for recurrent implantation failures. Now the diagnosis is on hysteroscopy, the diagnosis is on histopathology as well as immunohistochemistry. We have to combine all of these modalities to actually come to the diagnosis of chronic endometritis. It is not a very easy diagnosis to make, but if chronic endometritis is not treated, then your pregnancy rates are definitely going to be low. In fact, what we found is that the natural vaginal flora is actually disturbed in these women. So the lactobacilli, which should be more, is actually reduced, and the other pathogenic bacteria, which should be low, are actually reversed, and they are much higher in these women, and they have seen that the pregnancy rates is much lower in them. So if I were to give you a snapshot of, you know, what works and what doesn't, as you can see here, embryo glue, yes. Assisted hatching, doesn't work. Artificial oocyte activation, I will describe that to you in a minute, and we still haven't figured out whether it's actually working for us or not. Improvement of blood supply in terms of, you know, RG primes, the RG prime medications, or the sildenafils, or the vitamin E's, or the aspirins. All of these are the vasodilators that we sometimes tend to use when we see women with thin endometrium or we do not see a good vascular supply to the endometrium. For them, when we are giving them these medications, it does seem to make a difference in terms of implantation. Antioxidants, like we already spoke about, in terms of CoQ, melatonin and vitamin D, it does have a place. Immunotherapy, we still don't know. Immunological reasons for recurrent implantation failure or recurrent pregnancy losses, we still don't have a great clue as to how to treat them. Frankly, we don't have enough investigations to do to see whether they have an immunogenic problem for us to actually treat them, because treatment is wide. Steroids, you have immunoglobulins to be given. You can actually give them TNF-alpha and antagonists to treat them. But we don't know who needs these treatments. And all of these treatments are not as simple as giving an aspirin. They come with their own side effects. So this is where we are actually stuck, because we really don't have enough knowledge about the immunochemistry in terms of how do we assess and how do we pick up these patients who have immunogenic issues. Then we are talking about DHEA, like I said, which has shown to show benefit. Growth hormone, no, except for the specific groups that we spoke about. We used to do a lot of endometrial injuries, but that doesn't work anymore. We are talking about chronic endometritis, definitely has a play in terms of improving your implantation. Etosepam, we still need much more data before we can actually say it's made a difference in terms of live birth. Now, that is as far as all the other aspects are concerned. Let's move on towards Dr. Krishna's territory, which is embryology. And when you really look over the last few years or few decades, there has been a great sea change when we are talking about media and cultures. We used to do a sequential step, you know, in terms of media. Now we have completely moved on towards a single step medium. In fact, the skill that is required for an embryologist is slowly, we are trying to bring it down to bare minimum. Now, also when we are talking about the incubators, we have greatly moved on from large box incubators to tabletop incubators. And here, if you don't have to remove, you know, open the door of the huge incubator and disturb the culture that is going on for so many patients. You have just one little box in which you open, you just manage and evaluate the embryos of that particular patient, and you're not disturbing, you know, the embryos of the other patients. What has actually come up, and this is where we are at this point in time, is time lapse. Now, this is a great invention, extremely great to watch as well, wherein even without removing the embryo from the incubator, you're able to assess the quality of the embryo and the way it is dividing. Why is it important? Because these dynamics of an embryo is what will help you select the best quality embryo for you to go for a transfer. So where, you know, what is the division been like? What is the timeline that it's taken that division to take? If it follows the actual algorithms, then we will be able to pick up that particular embryo which has a higher potential for creating a pregnancy. But has that helped us in terms of actually, you know, improving our live birth rates? Probably it has reduced the time to pregnancy, but if you're looking at the cumulative live birth rate, it still hasn't made much of a difference. I still think there's a lot more that we have to learn about this machine before, you know, we can say it's making a difference to us. Laser-assisted hatching, like I said, it used to be done quite a lot, but now we have realized that its function, again, is in very few conditions, that is enabling us to do pre-genetic diagnosis. Now, vitrification, there is no lab that can be called as an IVF or a fertility clinic if you cannot offer vitrification. Vitrifying oocytes, sperm, and embryos has to be there. That is the basic minimum that an IVF lab has to be providing. And again, when we are really looking at the evolution of vitrification, we went from slow freezing, which used to be done in big box-like structures, to now reaching a point wherein we have automated vitrification devices, wherein if you just put the embryo into that particular device with the media, the machine does everything in terms of actually loading it onto the device and freezing it for you. So we are trying to automate it. Everything is looking at automation and trying to reduce the burden of the embryologist here. What about, you know, the confusion? You still tend to read, even now in 2021, you still have newspaper articles telling you that, you know, there was a mishap wherein the embryos were mixed. You have a Caucasian getting pregnant with a black child and vice versa. Why? Because ultimately, most of the work that is done in the lab is done by humans. And we can never completely eliminate human errors, which is why, again, we are looking at how do we automate it. So electron witnessing system is one way in which everything about that couple actually has a barcode. So all the dishes are labeled. And even when you remove one dish and you have that electronic you know, monitor, it tells you whether you've got the right patient's ID. So you check the ID of the patient, it records that, and then whenever you remove the dish, it tells you whether it's got the right patient's embryos, oocytes, or sperms. This has reduced the human error which otherwise could have happened. In fact, we have enabled our own electronic witnessing system, which has been devised by our own IT team here, like quite a few other inventions that OSS is known for. PGT. Like Mr. Sudhakar was telling you, our database for PGT is probably the second highest in the country, because we have been doing this for the last 7-8 years, and there are quite a few publications in international journals when we are talking about the efficacy as well as the implementation of PGT. Now, PGT-A is checking for aneuploidy, particularly to be useful on couples who have recurrent implantation failure or recurrent pregnancy loss, particularly for women who are more than, you know, 37, 38 years. This actually has reduced the time to pregnancy for us. It has reduced miscarriages for a woman and has made a great deal in terms of understanding why some people don't conceive even when they have had the 4 or 5 embryos that should have got them pregnant. There are quite a few disorders. for which, you know, in traditionally in the past, people were told to go for either donor egg or donor sperm. But again, like I said, a good fertility clinic should try to aim for the couple to have their own genetic child. And with the technology that is available now, with so many genetic disorders that are there, we actually are able for us to pick up those embryos. Thank you very much. We are able to pick up those embryos which have eliminated that particular genetic disorders. Now, next is omics. What is omics? Is actually understanding about that particular embryo is not just about just the chromosomes. We are going deeper than the chromosomes. We are looking at the translations into the proteins that it is secreting, whether they're actually there. What about the metabolic and the metabolic compounds that the embryo is secreting? Are they the right ones? Is there any disease that cannot be picked up in PGTA? Now remember, PGTA doesn't pick up everything. That's just like, you know, giving you a complete set, whether the whole set of chromosomes are there. It doesn't tell you about the genes that are particularly responsible for some of the disorders. If you do not know the genes, if you know the genes, yes, you do PGTM. But what about the genes that you don't know of? Towards that is where we are looking at in terms of the omics. And towards that, again, when we are talking about PGT, the thing that scares most of the clinicians is, are we damaging the embryo? And PGT can only be done if an embryo becomes a blastocyst. What about the embryos that don't become blastocyst? Don't they have any capacity to create a pregnancy? Are we actually overruling the fact that, like, you know, just because an embryo becomes a blastocyst, only that can create a pregnancy, thereby losing quite a few embryos? So all of this has actually led towards, again, trying to make it as less invasive as possible. And that is called as non-invasive PGT. Like how you have the NIPT, we have the non-invasive PGT. Here what we are doing is we are looking at the media in which the embryo is growing and take that little media and see the compounds and the, you know, different factors that that media is containing to tell us about the health of that particular embryo. A lot of research going in, and possibly within the next 5 years, we will be able to actually offer this instead of PGT. IVM, this is a special and a special baby of OASIS, and in fact we have collaborated with a very good group in Europe which is actually known for IVM, because we feel that in India we have the need for IVM to work. It is cheaper, it can replace IUI for you. It can reduce the cost in terms of multiple times that the woman has to undergo treatments. Yes, it is particularly for PCOS, but if you really look, 1 in 5 women who come to a fertility clinic are PCOS. And their journey tends to be extremely long. So for us, if IVM works for a woman, if it gives us the same pregnancy rates as IVF, then we have cracked it for them. And this is why we have started this collaboration with a European organization, and we are actually offering IVM, and probably in a year we'll have much more data to give you. Talking about fertility preservation, I mean, again, like I said, unless a fertility center can provide vitrification, you know, we are really not doing the job. And in the same breath, we also have to say that every fertility center right now should also be able to provide fertility preservation. This is where, you know, when, because quite a lot of women in their reproductive years are being diagnosed with malignancy. And the survival rate and the way that chemotherapy or radiotherapy or whatever treatments that they are having is giving us such good cure rates that later on in life they would want to have a family. And this is where, as fertility specialists, particularly in conjunction with the oncologist, we have to be able to offer them fertility preservations. Now, this is also something that hopefully within the next 2 or 3 years we should be able to offer. And that is ovarian tissue vitrification. There are more than 100 births in the world with this concept. And here what is happening is we are even not even taking the women who have malignancy through IVF. We are just removing a cortex of their ovary and vitrifying that. And once they finish their treatments, the same ovarian cortex is again re-implanted in the ovarian fossa or on the ovary itself. And therefore, they're, you know, they're no longer menopausal because it's secreting the hormones, and they also can conceive either naturally or with IVF with their own oocytes rather than again going for donor. Unfortunately, like how ovarian tissue has given us a lot of great deal of success, testicular tissue still hasn't reached that part yet. We still have to rely on sperm vitrification for that person to actually have his own genetic child if he were to get his own genetic child. Now, this is where a lot of work has already gone on. What is it that we should look forward to in future? Actually have a robot do your ICSI for you, do your vitrification for you. In fact, recently I read a paper in which in AI, they're going to get the machine to actually pick up the oocytes in the follicular fluid that is going to be given to them. So the fluid is going to be put on the table and the robot is the one who's going to be picking up these oocyte cumulus complexes, separate the cumulus and put it into another dish. So much of AI is actually going to be utilized in this field of fertility. So imagine machines, everything. Pickup is done by them, vitrification is done by that, time lapse is telling you about your embryo. So the embryologist just has to sit on his desk and tell us which embryo, look at the algorithms and tell us, which embryo to put back. Don't like injections, nobody likes injections. Are we towards looking at oral hormones? Yes, there's still a lot of work being done. They are still on phases 3 to 1 and 2. A lot more work is still going to be done, but hopefully we'll get there soon. This is not going to be possible in India because of PCP and DT, but this is where in some countries, in remote areas, the women are actually given an ultrasound machine that they do their own ultrasound, upload the images to the fertility center. They'll tell them the dosage that needs to be taken and tell them what time they need to come for egg pickup, which means that only one visit in which they come for the egg retrieval and one visit for the embryo transfer. So all the monitoring is going to be done by this self-operated ultrasound. Can we get oocytes? Can we get sperms for somebody who cannot or who's gone into premature ovarian failure? Well, till now, where research has gone on is we have been able to turn skin cells into mature oocytes. We have reached that stage in humans, but we haven't got to that point wherein the mature oocytes have fertilized. So we have got one step into the ladder. We still have a lot more steps to go. But again, if we have reached this, we might reach further as well. And this is where we are talking about in vitro activation of oocytes, wherein in women with very poor ovarian reserve or with premature ovarian failure, there is this concept of in vitro activation of oocyte, wherein we take a bit of the cortex of the woman and it is actually chopped into pieces because there is a kind of hipposignaling pathway that goes on in terms of oogenesis that is disrupted. And therefore, the cycle of folliculogenesis actually restarts. So they do that, they do some chemical activation as well with those pieces of cortex that has been chopped up and again reintroduced back into the ovary. It is being tried in some parts, mostly a lot of research is coming from Japan in this particular area. But again, we still need more work before it can actually take into practice. PRP, not a great advocate of PRP. Because I don't know whether it's a hit and miss game that we are playing with PRP right now. So it hasn't completely replaced or treated Asherman syndrome or even women with premature ovarian insufficiency where PRP is injected into the ovaries. Yes, possibly, again, one step onto the ladder, but we still have a lot more to do to understand this efficacy in terms of fertility industry. What about sperms? Sperms, we have actually gone a little step further when it comes to sperms rather than oocytes. Here we are able to get a mature sperm and even fertilizations have occurred. But again, embryo development is not something that we have seen in humans, but yes, we have seen it from mouse. You must have heard a lot about this three-parent baby. Now the concept behind this is when a woman gets older, obviously the nucleus is fine, but the cytoplasm in terms of the organelles, the mitochondria, it is not as healthy as it should be as when she is younger. So what we tend to do is, because the nucleus is where you have the genetic material of the mother, we leave that, we change the mitochondria and all the cytoplasm from a woman who's much younger, so that we get a much healthier cytoplasm with its organelles, with the woman's genetic material, and use that to create embryos. So that women, even whose oocytes have got extremely poor quality, are able to actually generate embryos with their own genetic material. CRISPR, this is gene editing, and frankly the concept behind this is being very noble, in which you're trying to actually cut and remove the genes which are pathogenic. But somehow this went into the wrong concepts, and people were trying to misuse this technology, and one clinician actually tried to eliminate HIV in the embryos by using this technique. He succeeded, but what happened was those children's lifespans were very short. So yes, technology is there, but we still need to understand the full implications of what this technology is going to do for us before we can actually offer it for routine use. The last and not the least is, what do we do about the uterus? We are looking at the eggs, we are looking at the sperm, we are looking at the lab, we have seen so much development going on there. But once an embryo is created, if the uterus is not ideal, if the endometrium is not ideal, what do we do? Yes, you're trying transplantation, but again, that comes with its own issues. Surrogacy, again, if the law was to take hold in India, which may not be, it might not be possible for everybody. So the future is looking at actually having a womb outside, which means that you will see your baby growing in your drawing room in this kind of container that is going to give the fetus the right kind of environment and the right kind of nutrients, enough for it to actually develop. Long way to go, but a lot of research is going on in Europe regarding this. So when we are talking about fertility, we are still getting future ready. And long way to go, but we are still struggling hard, and we hopefully in a few years' time, probably looking at how 1978 was to how 2021 is when we are talking about fertility, possibly in another decade we could be looking at completely different picture of providing fertility services. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Durga Rao ma'am, for amazing address. It's very elaborative and interesting, and you told already New Year things in infertility, like procedures, so many procedures. Even we didn't know the procedures names also, because it's a max, pixie, microfluids, and vitrification procedures, and use of growth hormone injections in poor responders, and omics procedures, use of atopison, and lot of procedures. Thank you, madam, and give a big applause to Dr. Durga Rao madam. Very interesting lecture. And now I will invite Dr. Kasturi Pramila madam to come on to dais and hand over a bouquet and memento to Dr. Durga Rao ma'am. Now we'll move on to next topic by Dr. Krishna Chaitanya, who is going to speak on, can fertility treatments guarantee 100% success? Success rates in 2021, a really check. Now I will call Purushottam to introduce Dr. Krishna Chaitanya.
Very good evening to everybody. Dr. Krishna Chaitanya Mantri Vadi is an expert in clinical embryology and cryopreservation of gametes and embryos. Apart from extensive knowledge in latest ART techniques, he is very passionate about the human embryology and constantly do research work in innovative approaches to improve the success rate in IVF treatments. At Oasis, his main area of work is cryobiology and IVF of oocytes. In vitro maturation of the oocytes, embryonic stem cells, andrology, and men's health in general. Currently, he is working on employing newer techniques to improve the success rates of in vitro fertilization in especially PCOD and recurrent IVF failure cases. Prior to OASIS, Dr. Krishna Chaitanya studied and practiced in Australia. Currently, he is also undertaking collaborative research work with the Department of Reproductive Biology, Monash Institute of Medical Research, Australia. He is also an Indian ambassador for Academic Affairs, Department of Reproductive Medicine and Early Human Development, Monash Institute of Medical Sciences, Australia. He carries a total 10 years of work experience. He regularly visits the Warangal Oasis Center, apart from the Hyderabad Oasis. I request him to kindly come out to the stage to deliver his topic today. Welcome, sir.
Small. Before lecture, any questions from audience to Dr. Durga Rao, ma'am?
I think nobody can able to ask.
Madam, can you elaborate on regarding the double protocol? You said some word.
So what we tend to do in a dual stimulation is after the egg retrieval. Now the egg retrieval is for the follicles that have crossed at least 14 millimeters. Now by the time that you have extracted these oocytes, you might still see from the next follicular wave, you will still see some follicles which are less than 10 to 12 millimeters, which are there, which haven't been recruited in this particular phase of ovarian stimulation. Now, in somebody who's already got a less number of oocytes, we have to wait for the next cycle of her periods. And then when you scan her at that time, you might not have the same number of oocytes, or rather the journey is going to be much longer. So what we tend to do is these follicles which haven't been recruited, we will again restart the stimulation 2 to 3 days after the egg retrieval. So what we tend to do is we give them letrozole to bring down their estrogen levels. We sometimes also use an antagonist because we want the LH levels and the progesterone levels also to fall. So we use these medications for at least 2 to 3 days. We scan them again on day 3 or even day 5 post egg retrieval. And if we see some follicles which are less than 10, then we restart the stimulation again. And I'm not able to tell you which number you should start dual stimulations because we sometimes have women who have only 1 or 2 follicles on each ovary. Now, if I see again 2 follicles again on the ovary after 3 days of the initial stimulation, I'll restart. Or sometimes what we tend to do is if I have women who do not have the desired number of embryos on day 3 or day 5, I can restart and do a dual stimulation if I see adequate number of follicles. This is particularly useful only for people who have poor ovarian reserve because we want to collect as many oocytes as we can. And what's also been seen, which is very interesting, is that the embryos that are created from the second batch of oocytes, actually their aneuploidy rate is also similar, if not better, than the follicular stage embryos, as well as the quality, irrespective of what your baseline progesterone levels were or estrogen levels were. So this has enabled us to actually utilize the follicular waves. What we had initially thought was there's going to be only one follicular wave in which you see a dominant follicle and the others undergo atresia. What we have understood now is there are multiple follicular waves, and after you utilize one follicular wave and extract the eggs, you have other follicular waves that are starting off towards the mid-follicular or late follicular phase that you can utilize for the stimulation in the second half of the cycle. So this depends on the age. If a woman is above 37, we offer them PGTA, which is checking the aneuploidy rates and then putting down the embryo, which is genetically normal. Also for people who have recurrent pregnancy losses, if you have eliminated uterine factors, if you have eliminated thrombophilia screening, you have looked at all other factors, then we tend to offer them genetic screening of their embryos, pick up a genetically normal embryo and improve their success rates. Because so this...
they will be completely normal before implanting.
Before we can say that they're completely normal, the composition is normal in the sense they have 23 pairs of chromosomes. they do not have any major deletions or additions. But the genes of the chromosomes are not something that can be picked up in aneuploidy. So if there's a particular genetic disorder in the family, then we actually have to do something which is called as PGTM, which is monogenic disorder. So in them, we pick up the embryos, eliminate the embryos which have that particular disorder, and then go ahead. You're talking about self-oocytes? Because, according to the ICMR and
yes, according nowadays we are being at the 70 years of age.
I'm sorry, we have quite a few people who are disreputing our field, but according to the ICMR, you're not supposed to treat a woman who has crossed 45 and a man who's 55. Those are our regulations. I wish I could answer for them, madam, but it is not, it's not ethical, it's not ethical. You're absolutely right, not ethical at all, but the regulations are clear that you should not treat a woman who's more than 45.
Madam, it's late, but take 2 minutes regarding AMH. Nowadays, girls are coming AMH with very low, and whether to do the test or not, or whether to inform to the patient very low AMH, go for IVF. Because once AMH is very low, we advise to go for IVF. Next cycle, she came with pregnancy. She's so whether to tell or not, or whether to do or not. So any newer inventions in AMH testing?
Frankly, you're absolutely right. There are different, you have to interpret it based on the age. So even if I do not have an AMH report with me, but if you have to advise somebody about either fertility preservation or conception methods, the first thing that we have to take into account is her age. Which is why if you have a 24-year-old woman with an AMH of 0.9 versus a 36-year-old woman with an AMH of 0.9, the 24-year-old woman is more likely to come back saying that you told me I need IVF but I have conceived. Whereas the 36-year-old woman may need IVF. So this is where, but you know, not giving them the information if it has been done. If it was not done, yes. You know, it's blissful, ignorance is blissful in that respect. But if it has been done, we still have to tell them that, you know, there is a chance that they may need fertility treatments, and if they have not tried natural conception at all, then we'll have to devise some kind of a model in which you say, try naturally for 2 months, IUI for 2 months, and if you still haven't conceived within 4 to 6 months, then let's do IVF. But you know, you have to plan the journey for them. You cannot ignore it completely, but you're right. But it's more the younger women who are likely to come back with a pregnancy than the older ones.
Hi ma'am, I just wanted to ask about PGTA a little bit more. So ma'am, as you know that you've recommended that we do PGTA for patients who are above 37, mostly we would expect low number of yield. Would it solve any problem? It may decrease the time to pregnancy.
Yeah, absolutely right, Shreya. Yes. So there are only two advantages to this by doing PGTA for a woman who's more than 37 or 38. One is the time to pregnancy, but the second thing is the reduction in miscarriages. So what you tend to do is, if you don't do PGT, now you have 4 embryos. Right. You will pick up probably the 1 embryo which is more likely to give a pregnancy, and you'll do it in the first transfer and you'll achieve a pregnancy. Or you will either put them, you know, 2 to each, and you'll still get to the same outcome. But what we are doing with PGT is you're reducing her miscarriages. That I think is more important. You're right. But the cumulative live birth rate, so based on the number of embryos that you have, the cumulative live birth rate doesn't change. Absolutely not.
And also the cost factor, ma'am, because the embryo biopsy is going to be much more higher than the second transfer.
Okay, it depends on, this is why it is as an offer for aneuploidies for women who are more than 37, because obviously the risk of miscarriages, you know, that will put a woman back by at least 4 or 5 months.
Okay.
Which is not something that she can afford at 37, 38.
Okay.
So you have to take the whole picture into account. Now suppose you have somebody with a recurrent implantation failure. They've already tried this. They've had at least 4 or 5 embryos put back, not resulted in a pregnancy.
Yeah.
You know, PGTA. Recurrent pregnancy loss, where their concern is not pregnancy. They can achieve a pregnancy by themselves. They don't need a fertility specialist. But there, in those people, you're trying to reduce their risk of miscarriage.
Yeah, that place it's justified by probably due to.
Yeah, but then at 37, 38, you have to look at the timeline.
Yeah, 37, 38. The number of embryos versus the number of transfer versus the biopsy cost is something. At Warangal especially, it's very difficult to judge.
Kavya doesn't seem to find a problem with that. She seems to say that's quite a
her category
of her. But it's, yes, you're right. But then this is where, like, you know, sometimes for a 38-year-old woman, her reserve is already limited. And, you know, if that doesn't result in a pregnancy the first attempt, and by the time they actually get to a point, she would be a recurrent implantation failure or come into the poor ovarian reserve category, for which we really can't do much about.
Okay, ma'am. And have you combined progesterone priming with dual stimulation, ma'am?
Progesterone priming with dual
TPO stimulation with
you
dual
mean to say rather than using an antagonist, use a progesterone?
Correct. Yeah.
Those you know, variations of the Shanghai protocol, there are loads of variations. In fact, depending on what the economic status is of the patient and how soon you need to control the LH, you can use progesterone. The simplest, in fact, most of our donors actually go for the progesterone stimulations right now rather than giving them antagonists. Okay. But yes, it works just as effectively.
Thank you,
madam. After uterine artery embolization, patient is asked for IVF. Can we suggest or?
We should have thought of that before the uterine artery embolization. In fact, uterine artery embolization and the MR ultrasound, for the fibroids, MRFUS, all of these procedures should be done only once a woman has completed her fertility. Yes, there are a lot of case reports in literature which tells you that even after uterine artery embolization, the woman has conceived, has had a child and all of that. But these are still case reports. You know, what is ideal is for the woman not to have any kind of procedure which is going to reduce her chances of implantation. Some might still, you know, rejoin and get a good vascular network where an implantation is still possible, but preferably not to undergo those treatments before.
Sorry for that delay. I'll try and keep it as short as possible. It's really nice to see on a working day the hall being full. So let me, I don't know if you can give me. Okay, wonderful. So I think in the present world, the patient is not wrong in asking 100% success. They're coming with a lot of hope. And so do we want to give our best treatments, but does that mean we give them a false hope of 100%? We're talking about so many technology that's improved. It's available to all of us, you know, district, place, taluka, to a city. I think everywhere, we are no less. The Western world or India, I think the treatments available, which are accessible to the common man, is no different now. So can we really give 100% success? So it's a small effort from Oasis to show you what the facts and figures are. What do we sit with our patients and counsel them to reality? And that's what fertility practice is all about. I think most of our job is counseling and putting, we know the success is limited. All of us know the bitter truth here. But how do we polish it and put it on the platter so the patient accepts it? That's what this lecture is all about. I think, what is success? I think that's the first thing to define. You know, do you really say, I've got 10 blastocysts frozen? Does that mean that the lady really did well? Or I just have 10 people who had cycles, all 10 came up with a positive beta HCG. Does that mean that I've really done the best this month? Or do we say cardiac activity that we see is what is a success, or live birth? You know, it's got multiple dimensions, and that is what is key performance indicators. And we can't really dissect all of this to the patient and say, you know what, my clinic has got an implantation of 70% take-home baby of so much percentage. All that they want is a baby in their hand when they go home. So what is in reality is what we need to see. It's 1978 to 2021, Dr. Durga took us through a whole journey of what has been done, where we are going, and where possibly we could also progress. But the bitter truth, our success rates are still 50 or 60%. 40% of the couples still, I think, are going to face failure. So how do we, and why are the new treatments not letting us reach that 80 or 100%? So it's just facts and figures. So if somebody's planning for a natural conception, younger people, if there are no comorbidities, complications regular with the act of sexual intercourse, with no contraceptive measures, 84 of the 100 will fall pregnant. Well, that's 2003 statistics. I'm sure there's a slight dipping, but I think underlining that word, no contraception, regular intercourse, I think that's what most of the couples are lacking these days. They've really got no time for themselves, and that's where things are getting more and more difficult day by day, but at least 84 of them should get away. 10 to 15% will miscarry, even in a natural conception. So with an IU or IVF, people miscarry, and they really, sometimes it becomes a legal conflict. That's because we're not counseling and putting the facts and figures properly in front of them. Right from the beginning, we're giving them a rosy picture saying that everything is going to work out, and when things don't work out is where the whole conflict is starting. Even in a natural conceived pregnancy, 15% can miscarry. We're doing an in vitro thing. Miscarriage is a part and of this game, what we're doing here. Age, I think the most important aspect of it, I'll not go deeper into it, but I think age is detrimental. That's going to bring your success down. Your duration of subfertility is absolutely important. In fact, the research says people who've been subfertile for more than 3 years, their conception rates are coming down to 1% to 3% if they're trying naturally. So your duration of subfertility is important. That's why in history taking, we would want to know how long they've been married, how long they've been trying, and then make a treatment plan. We just don't look straight away at the ovarian reserve or the sperm parameters and say, do IVF ICSI. I think we're first taking the history, examining, and then going ahead with that. BMI, absolutely detrimental. We got to be looking at it. So that's what I'll start off with. That's the general picture of what the success rates could be. If you're just doing an ovulation induction, OITI cycle, probably you're looking at a less than 15% pregnancy rate. With IUI, it goes up to probably 20% on an average. And with IVF ICSI, it's probably 50%, and that's where it plateaus up. Now, if you're getting into subgroups, so ovulation inductions with Clomid and Letrozole, I think somewhere in between 30 to 40% out there. So this was the 2010 FAST trial where they looked at the live birth, no drugs. Natural cycle monitoring only gives you a 6 to 10% pregnancies and live births. With Letroz or stimulated cycle where a gonadotropin gives you the maximum. So the take home thing is the success rates with the natural cycle are probably very, very less. You've got to be looking at a stimulated cycle to optimize and improve on your success rates. A monofollicular IUI cycle or a ovulation induction cycle probably gives you lesser success than a multifollicular, but again, we're only looking at 2 or 3 follicles and nothing beyond that. Overall, an IUI is probably giving you a live birth rate of 8 to 22% and a miscarriage of 9%, and with advancing age, it is going down. Unexplained group, if you're just doing expectant management, you're only looking at 1 to 4% of fecundity or pregnancy there. That's where a stimulated cycle can take up the live birth to a maximum of 30%. Even with donor sperm IUI cycles, the success cannot be 50, 60, 70%. It is around about 20%, similar to what the husband's cycle IUI can offer to us. So even with the donor sperm IUI, the success is around about 20%. So coming to IVF ICSI per se, if you're looking at live birth rates from frozen embryo transfer cycle, HFEA, which is the UK database, 2018 statistics say it's a 30% take-home baby rate. UK, which is the best country doing everything state-of-art, where they only do elective single embryo transfer for all the women less than 37 years, and they quote a live birth rate of 30%. The American data, which is SART, is saying 47%. That's the world global statistics. So what is it that we are doing at OASIS? Our fresh embryo transfer cycles, we had a live birth rate of 57%. And this is my 2019 live birth data. 2020 is yet to come next month. And with frozen embryo transfers, we've been able to maintain a success rate of 63% take-home baby rate, which means of every 10 couples who come to us, 5 to 6 are going home with a child. So that's been our trend over the years as to with our fresh and frozen cycles. Of course, we all know that frozen cycles slightly has got a better success rate, and we advocate and do a lot of freeze-all cycles, and that's what has helped us maintain our success rate steadily over the years. Even with donor oocyte cycle, American data says you can only go up to 50%. Just because you've used donor eggs doesn't mean the success is going to be 80 or 90 or 100%. The American data is 49%, and at OASIS we were at 57%. Embryo donation, where everything is donor, egg donor, sperm donor. I'm not taking you to the legislature because I think the newer ICMR guidelines might actually delete this particular option of treatment, but at this point we could still offer embryo donation. It has to be anonymous from a donor egg and a donor sperm and not a patient embryo unless they've legally consented it. Even with donor embryos where the lady's uterus is just used as a surrogate carrier, the success is probably around 40-50% and nothing beyond that. OASIS success rate is around about at 62% in the year 2019. Severe male factor, usage of testicular sperm to do the ICSIs, that's the latest Chinese data which was published in Nature, where they quoted a live birth of 45%. OASIS published its data in fertility sterility in the year 2020 at the ASRM conference, and we had a live birth of 40% as well. So one, I think severe male factor donor is not an option. There's so many more options which Dr. Durga took us through which can help us. So let's think out of the box. Gone are those days where we just say for the man, take the sperm, do the ICSI, or there's no sperm, go. Let's go for donation. There's so much more that can happen, and that's the facts and figures of the live birth rate globally. If people are able to give 45%, we have the same technology, we can also look forward to do the same thing. The Cochrane database, should we do a day 3 or a day 5 transfer? A day 3 transfer gives you a lesser live birth rate of, on an average of 29%, but a blastocyst can give a 40 to 45% pregnancy rates, and so at OASIS. We have a clinical pregnancy rate close to 60% with blastocyst transfer. We strictly advocate and we encourage couples to have an extended blastocyst culture at OASIS. Should we be putting one or two embryos? That's always debatable, how many numbers to put back. Putting back two embryos or one embryo, the live birth is not significantly changing, but the incidence of multiple pregnancies is going high, and the morbidity and the complications, all of us know, is something that we won't want. So that's a quick chart which probably helps all of us understand and apply in our clinics how do we go about and put how many embryos. If you're putting day 3 embryos, I'm not talking about euploid PGS screen, let's only look at all other category. So anybody who's less than 37 years of age, day 3 embryos, probably you could go in between 2 or 3 embryos, but blastocyst, you strictly stop it at 2, nothing beyond 2. It's only after the age of 40 is where we're putting more number of embryos because we know the aneuploidy is going up and the implantation rates are coming down. This is a freely downloadable paper from Fertility Sterility published in the year 2017, but can be a wonderful guide for us to decide. Putting more would not result in a 100% chance of pregnancy. The success is going to plateau at 40%. You're going to deal with a lot of complications with multiple pregnancies. So I think we got to be really have a controlled and a balanced approach. It's about empowering your patient with information and knowledge. And I'm sure they always will think the right way and will understand when failure happens. It's counseling that's more important. So I think now oocyte vitrification has become a regular thing and it's no longer considered experimental. In fact, at OASIS, most of our donor cycles are vitrified oocytes, and I think we seem to be having a good live birth rate of 47%, where the American statistics says it's around about 43%. IVM, which is what we really have been practicing for quite some time, and we have been able to maintain a live birth rate of 30 to 35%, wherein a traditional IVF would give us a 40 to 50% success rate. With PGTA, there's so much of debate and discussion that just happened, a lot of question-answer interaction out there. I think at this point in time, it's more of reducing the time to pregnancy, but definitely has got a role with RIF and RPL patients, and more with the advanced middle age group. So if you really break them out in their age group, I think it's more of the women above the age of 40. If you compare with no screening versus screening, I think the women 40 and above really benefit. again, availability of the numbers, as Dr. Shreya picked up, is a concern and challenge, but at least it helps the patient deal it in the right way. That's the last slide of my presentation. I think this one question is there in our thoughts, in patients' thoughts, is IVF conception safe? The myth, the belief is still prevalent in educated and all classes across that IVF could lead to an abnormal conception, and that's the latest data available for us, where it says the incidence is 9% when you compare with the natural conception, which it's 6.6%. Statistically, I don't think that's any different, 7 versus 9%. And when you're really looking at specific abnormalities cardiac or genitourinary tract anomalies, everywhere, I think there isn't an alarming trend of abnormalities in the conceptions which are from the various ART cycles. So I think that's what I wanted to bring it across to you all, the numbers about the success. There isn't 100%. I'm not saying it's a myth, but it's not possible. You know, we cannot be doing exactly what the nature does. That's where I started off showing you what the natural rates are. Even there, failure is possible. Miscarriage is possible. So is the ART treatments. So I think counseling is an essential element and a very good weapon. You've got to be empowering them with information. Transparency is what would help us deliver what we're here to deliver. Thank you so much. Any questions, I'll be more than happy to take.
Complications during surgery when compared to with the normal section, because we have recently seen many more complications.
All right. I think I'll get Dr. Durga to answer that question because I'm not an obstetrician. I don't know if there's going to be any complications during surgery for an IVF.
I don't know about cesarean sections and complications, but yes, the fact is some of the pregnancies of IVF might have, in fact, the frozen transfers. What we have seen is that the hypertensive disorders are slightly more in pregnancies with frozen embryo transfers, which is why we tend to actually take care by giving them all these vasodilators and aspirin and everything else. So antenatally, they might have some issues in terms of preterm labors, low birth weight, and hypertensive disorders. Cesarean section as such, there hasn't been much data to say that an IVF pregnancy is going to give us more complications during surgery in terms of either PPH or anything. That hasn't been actually spoken about. But yes, antenatally, there are a few complications that we have to take care of.
All right. Thank you so much. Well, I was just showing you the 2090 statistics. So what Dr. Durga does is she creates a competition between all our branches. So every December we have a statistics meeting. And in fact, I just got all the results of 2020 statistics. And it's proud, even Dr. Kavya doesn't know that Warangal is the best IVF center of all my 11 branches. They are the best in 5 categories and you are on the top of it. So congratulations, Team Warangal. And thanks for all the support. I think that's what helped them become the best. I have got Banjara Hills, Miapur, which have been there for long, a senior team out there, but Dr. Kavya really gives us a lot of complex. And I think the clientele, what we get from Warangal branch, there's so much of learning that we all have. It just motivates us to do more and more. So thank you, ma'am. It's a wonderful journey being with you here in Warangal. Thank you. But congratulations, you are the first.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your warm welcome. Dear all, please bear me with for next 20 minutes because this is going to be a very practical thing which we are going to deal in our day-to-day practice. So role of hysteroscopic interventions in ART, this is why I picked this topic, is because many people don't have hysteroscopies done outside and they ask me that, can't you manage in scan looking at the uterus, can't you decide whether the uterus is suitable or not for a transfer or for a pregnancy? But there are few things which we have to actually look into depth. So why to evaluate the cavity pre-IVF? What are the methods we have? What are the comparison between the different methods? What are the indications and impact of hysteroscopy? So why to evaluate the cavity? Can we see the unseen? Yes, there are few things which we can only see in hysteroscopies. So looking into the outpatient hysteroscopy, this is the routine investigation done before ART. This is the ASRM conclusion. It says that the outpatient hysteroscopy should be a part of the infertility workup before ART, even in patients with normal HSG or transvaginal scan. This is especially relevant in cases with prior failed ART cycles. And Cochrane says they included 10 trials. For a typical clinic with a 22% live birth rate, performing a screening hysteroscopy would be expected to result in live births between 25 and 32%. But they have pooled the analysis, but the final conclusion said that there is no increase in the live birth rate. So high quality evidence, there is no high quality evidence to support the routine use in general and subfertile population. But a low quality evidence suggests that the routine hysteroscopy improves the live birth and clinical pregnancy rates. Now we know the indications for hysteroscopy and also the contraindications: acute PID, active herpes infection, pregnancy, and medically unstable patient. As we all know, office hysteroscopies are being also done routinely in the day-to-day practice. Here we don't need to go, we are not going to use any anesthesia, any NSAIDs or painkillers. No need to use of speculum or tenaculum. Vaginal cavity is distended using the distension media, and the patient discomfort is decreased with painkillers if required. This is a vaginal scopic approach, which is a no-touch technique. No assistants are required. The rigid hysteroscope or a flexible hysteroscope less than 3.5 mm can be used, and patient can herself observe normal and abnormal findings. Routine prophylactic antibiotics are not required, and vaginoscopic approach preserves the integrity of the hymen. So outpatient hysteroscopy, NSAIDs, there is a grade B evidence for this routine use of NSAIDs before 1 hour of hysteroscopy. And routine cervical preparation before outpatient hysteroscopy not to be used. Miniature hysteroscopes 2.7 mm with 3 to 3.5 mm sheath should be used for diagnostic. Outpatient hysteroscopy significantly, they reduce the discomfort for the patients. Flexible hysteroscopes, yes, always they give less pain during this outpatient scopes. Rigid hysteroscope may provide better images, fewer failed procedures, quicker examination time, and reduced cost. Uterine distension with the normal saline appears to reduce the incidence of vasovagal episodes, and they improve the image quality completed more quickly compared with the carbon dioxide. Operative outpatient hysteroscopy using bipolar electrosurgery requires use of normal saline to act as both distension and the conducting medium. So available evidence fails to show whether paracervical block is inferior, equivalent, or superior to alternative analgesic technique in terms of efficacy and safety for women undergoing cervical dilatation and uterine interventions. So as we know, the indications: polyps, submucous leiomyomas, uterine septa, intrauterine additions, misplaced or embedded IUDs, tubal cannulation and phalloscopies, tubal sterilization also. Going into the actual indications, first one is the polyp. As we know, prevalence of the endometrial polyps is found to be 32% in infertile couples. Diagnosis is with transvaginal ultrasound, both 2D and 3D. For infertile patient with a polyp, surgical removal is recommended to allow natural conception or ART a greater opportunity to be successful, and this is a level A evidence. So here are the pictures showing a 2D and a 3D image where we can pick up the polyp. So polyps in IUI, should we remove or should we go ahead? These are the studies, Cochrane review 2015. It says that, you know, hysteroscopic polypectomy results in greater than fourfold increase in clinical pregnancy among subfertile or infertile women who subsequently undergo IUI. So, but the studies didn't mention the size of the polyp, the location of the polyps. They have only given us the information that the polyp is excised. Looking into the another systematic review in 2017, the average cumulative pregnancy rates from both studies they have combined, it is 55.3% for the women who had hysteroscopic polypectomy compared to 25% who didn't have the polypectomy. So in IVF, after polypectomy, what is the timing? When should a woman, she should go for embryo transfer? 2012 study looked at a greater than 6 months and less than 6 months interval between the procedures, and they found no difference in the outcomes. So as soon as we have done with the hysteroscopic polypectomy, the subsequent month can be preferred for an embryo transfer. And starting for IVF, after 1, 2, or 3 or more menstrual cycles following hysteroscopic polypectomy, there is no difference. So the overall recurrence rate of the polyp is very low, approximately 3%. So we will have to make sure that there is the polyp has been excised completely. Sorry for the bad quality. So I think this is the hysteroscopic video of a woman who is having an endometrial polyp. This is the polyp as shown in the figure. So we can use a scissors or a resectoscope depending upon the size of the polyp, location of the polyp, and the number of polyps. And if it is a recurrent polyp case, maybe a resectoscope can be used compared to the scissors. So coming to the uterine anomalies, the prevalence is 5.5% in an unselected population, whereas in infertile women it is 8%. But women who are having miscarriages, uterine anomalies incidence is 13.3%. In infertile women who had miscarriages, it is 24.5%. So not going into the details of the classification systems, but we need to know at least three classification systems, that is ASRM, ESHRI, and Coombs criteria. So this is the ASRM classification for the septate uterus, which is complete and partial septum. And they also classified a different class, which is arcuate uterus. ASRM, arcuate uterus is depth less than 1 centimeter and angle more than 90, whereas septate uterus depth more than 1.5 centimeter and angle less than 90. Bicornuate uterus, the depth is more than 1 centimeter. So this is how we can differentiate the uterine anomalies. But in ESHRI or SJ classification, there is no concept for the arcuate uterus. The septate uterus is classified in U2, which is U2A partial, U2B is complete. So this is the U2 septate uterus. It is defined as the uterus with normal outline and an internal indentation at the fundal midline exceeding 50% of the uterine wall thickness. So here they took the uterine wall thickness. And the other criteria is congenital uterine malformations by expert. This is Coombs criteria. They have looked into the indentation to the myometrial wall thickness and the angle of indentation and the length of the indentation. So when the indentation, it is more than 110% and the angle of indentation less than 140 degree and length of indentation when it is more than 10 mm, then the criteria is fit into the septate uterus. But when we compare the three classification systems, which is better? ESHRI overdiagnosis and ASRM underdiagnosed. So the Coombs criteria has come up with the depth of indentation and the angle and the myometrial thickness. The reason for diagnosis is to avoid surgeries on arcuate uterus, which is considered as a normal variant. So the number of normal or arcuate uterus and septate uterus according to the original ESHRI and ASRM and Coombs criteria, here we can see. If you see in ESHRI, normal uterus is 20, more are septate uterus, which are 80, and nothing in gray zone. That means they are either categorizing the patient into normal or arcuate or septate. ASRM, we have patients who are morely classified into arcuate uterus, few into septate, and there are people in gray zone. So in that group of women, maybe there will be an inter-observable variability when a doctor is actually quoting them into a septate uterus, some other might not feel. But when we use the Coombs criteria, 82 women are actually categorizing, they are in the normal group, and 18 are septate, and there are no people in the gray zone. So currently, all the radiologists are using the Coombs criteria. So we will also have to slowly start implementing this into our day-to-day practice. So septate uterus, yes, 3D or MRI, both are equivalent when we have an efficient skill to pick up the septate or bicornuate uterus on 3D. MRI are required only in cases where we have a confusion, which is an operated septate cases, or when there is a dysmorphic uterus, or when there are multiple associations or when we have a septum associated with a fibroid, huge fibroid. So in these cases, MRI can be advised. So looking into the sensitivity specificity, yes, 3D is equivalent to MRI. So the consensus about septum is, in a patient with infertility and prior pregnancy loss or a poor obstetric outcome, it is reasonable to consider septum incision. And in a patient without infertility or prior pregnancy loss, it may be reasonable to consider septum incision following counseling regarding potential risks and benefits. So when you are going to operate a patient who is having a pregnancy loss, it is advisable. But when there is no history, incidentally you have diagnosed a lady with a septum, and if it is a small subseptum, it is not a very deep septum, then you will have to counsel the patient regarding the risks of the surgery as well. So there is a Cochrane meta-analysis in 2017 which said there is no evidence to support this surgical intervention in women of reproductive age group. There is this TRUST trial, the randomized uterine septum transection trial, which is a Dutch study. They have said that the live birth rate in a woman with surgery is increased to 70% from 35% with surgery. So actually when people are getting operated, are actually not having a really great live birth rate. And this study is underway in Netherlands, still yet to complete. So the consensus as of date today is septal resections are not to be advised on a regular basis, but a patient-to-patient basis should be taken into consideration. Most of the women with septate uterus have normal reproductive function. So it is considered as a normal variant if it is a minor. RQT is considered as a normal variant. So how to do a septal incision? Tips: prior 3D identification of the anomaly. Follicular phase is the best one. No pre-treatments are required. Bipolar or Versa point for nulliparous or cervical stenosis. Scissors, bipolar are safer than monopolar. Normal saline which has no hyponatremia. Incision midline. When to stop, mark at the fundus. Panoramic visualization at regular intervals. Lap or ultrasound guided for complete septum or complex anomalies should be there. So this is a picture of our own case where first A and B is complete septum pre and post resection. So C and D are the partial septum pre and post resection. So C and D is the partial, which is subseptum easily we can do, but a deeper complete septum resection cases, rather than doing in a single sitting, maybe they can be done in a dual sitting modalities. So because of the traction effect on the anterior and posterior uterine walls, a slight retraction may occur after septum incision. If the separation is too deep, it can result in a perforation. If the separation is too shallow, it can result in a residual septum. So how to avoid a perforation? Proper distension of the cavity, not to exceed recommended infusion pressures. Scissor handles should open and close in the proper plane of the cavity. And a ultrasound or a laparoscopy can be used simultaneously. End point of the surgery to be decided when the ostea are visible and fundus seems uniform. How to avoid a remnant septum? You should have adequate distension and visualization and a surgical expertise and use of ultrasound. So we all know the safety issues, how to take care of these things when it happened. Septal resection, yes, it improves the obstetrical outcomes and decreases abortion rates and increases pregnancy rates and live birth. But there is still lack of evidence in the randomized trials. It does not delay ART. People think that if there is a septum, this lady might not conceive. It is not the same. There may be effect in the embryo peri-implantation and perinatal outcomes owing to the unintentional fibrosis and altered intrauterine pressure dynamics. Cervical incompetence can be there. If we operate, they might have a chances of Asherman syndrome also. So surgery is simple and safe with reduced morbidity and not recommended in women without poor reproductive outcomes. Improved endometrial assessment after septoplasty and increases confidence in those attempting to conceive a pregnancy spontaneously or by ART. But there are associated surgical risks. So clinical pregnancy improvement and live birth rate improvement, and there is a decrease in pregnancy loss. As we know, uterine septum, when it is there, it causes malpresentation, IUG, or placental abruption and placental mortality also. The unanswered questions are relationship of obstetric outcome with size and size of the uterine septa. Specific method for hysteroscopic septum incision is not still yet documented. And recommending danazol or GnRH agonist for thinning the endometrium prior to hysteroscopic septum incision a specific length of time after hysteroscopic septum incision and before conceiving. So these are the unanswered questions. Metroplasty, we know abdominal metroplasty, septum as I have discussed. The indications are recurrent pregnancy loss, preterm births, primary or secondary infertility. So scissors or monopolar hook can be used. This is the preoperative and postoperative representation of the uterine cavity ratio. Here we take the distance in millimeter between the uterine horns divided by the length of the uterine septum and multiplied by 100. If the ratio is less than 10, it is good. But if the ratio is more than 10%, higher incidence of spontaneous abortions will be there. So residual septum, how to identify it? So this is the ultrasound mid-coronal view of the complete septate uterus before hysteroscopic metroplasty. With all the measurements of the septum, the uterine wall thickness is Y and the base of the septum is X and the length is Z. So here this is A is the preoperative image and B is the postoperative image. So here we can see the fundal uterine wall thickness is 1 cm, confirming the complete incision of the septum. So this is a completed case. So reproductive outcomes after hysteroscopic metroplasty, we should take care about the cervical incompetence and rupture risk. So hybrid septate uterus and bicorporeal septate uterus under appropriate sonographic and laparoscopic monitoring should be done. T-shaped septate uterus, we will have to measure the distance between the ostia, length of the uterine cavity and possible section in the width also, and the safety margin should be located. So this is the technique for the surgery for the T-shaped uterine cavity. Two incisions are given. Incisions on the fibromuscular constriction rings in the isthmic areas of the uterine side walls are given, and incisions on the anterior and the posterior walls are given. So this is for unicornate uterus, transcervical uterine incision procedure. This is the dotted line of the incision where unicornate uteruses, if they are having a history of very preterm births, not going up to 34 weeks at least, if she has been delivered at 28 weeks, so this can be attempted, but not in a routine thing. So this is a 4 centimeter long vertical incision on the right lateral uterine wall of a left unicornate uterus. The arrow means the orifice of the fallopian tube. So first a transverse incision should be given and continued by a vertical incision. So this is the panoramic view of the cavity of the same patient who has undergone metroplasty for a unicornate uterus. So resection of the rudimentary horn and prophylactic cerclage can improve obstetrical outcomes. Bicornate uterus, as we know, partial and complete. So here the risks in patients with bicornuate unicolis is high incidence of infertility, repeated first trimester abortions and IUGR, fetal malposition, preterm labor and all these complications. So when you consider a surgery for a bicornuate uterus, surgical intervention is usually not indicated in the absence of reproductive difficulties. A woman with history of recurrent pregnancy loss with no other infertility issues can have Strassmann's metroplasty. Placement of cervical cerclage may increase fetal survival in these patients with cervical incompetence. So patients are not to be given direct advice to go for a surgery in unicornuate, bicornuate uteruses, but should be advised only if they have a bad obstetric history or a previous history of repeated miscarriages, or any patient who is having a history of inadequacy for a fetus to grow itself. In these uteruses only, these surgeries can be attempted. So coming into the myomas, not going into the details, not going into the medical management also, as today's topic is hysteroscopic intervention. Women with gestational desire who is wanting fertility immediately, submucous type 0 to 2 can be removed in hysteroscopically. When it is type 3 intramural, you can try uliprestol acetate if it is available currently, and consider rescan her and consider the surgery if the size is going above 5 cm, that is type 4. Type 5 and 6, you have to give an option for surgery versus the non-medical options like uterine artery embolization. And also uliprestol can be advised when it is a case of a complex fibroids, when a patient is having many fibroids, for them also medical management plus surgical should be combined. So this is the hysteroscopic classification, types 0, 1, 2, 3. So as we know, the step W classification, which mentions the size, location, extension, penetration, and the involvement of the lateral walls. 0 to 4 score, that is group 1, low complexity hysteroscopic myomectomy can be done. But when the score is above 5, we will have to consider it is in a two-step involving the medical management, that is the GnRH agonist. Score above 7, consider alternatives to the hysteroscopic technique. So as we know, TVS we can pick up with TVS 3D also. And SIS is the routine thing which we can do in our day-to-day practice. MRI, yes, in complex cases. You can actually diagnose these fibroids. You can do a Hofe's hysteroscopy initially. And then also you can plan the operative surgery on a later date also. So SIS and hysteroscopy are equivalent in diagnosing these conditions. Misoprostol, yes, can be given for patient on the day of surgery, 200 to 400 mcg. Vasopressin preparation, direct intracervical stromal injection of 5 ml in 11, 2, 4 and 8 o'clock position can be given. We will have to alert the anesthetist. Aspirate before injection and administered, 2 units should be administered. And the cardiovascular response before second injection, you will have to monitor. This reduces the blood loss, operative time, and intravasation also, and this facilitates the cervical dilatation. Use of GnRH agonist, this is the AAGL practice report 2013 in actually a premenopausal woman group. It says that there is the decrease in the reduced fluid deficit among this group of women where the GnRH agonist have been used. So methods, we know mechanical just cut stock method and using a resectoscope, using a Versa point, using MyoSure or TrueClear or laser also. So tips are resection should always start from one side and move horizontally across the other side. After initial excision of the intracavitary portion of the fibroid, the intramural component will typically expel into the cavity. Repeated increasing and reducing the intrauterine pressure often pushes the intramural component of the into the cavity, facilitating the excision. This is the hydrostatic massage. So we know the advantages, but the disadvantages are it requires long and steeper learning curve, insertion and reinsertion required in large myomas, and insertion, cutting and retrieval and reinsertion cycles pose a major problem with cervical stenosis also. The complications are trauma, fluid retention, infection and hemorrhage. This is MyoSure morcellator, those who are using morcellators for many myomas or huge myomas. And how to manage bleeding during morcellation? Typically the bleeding with hysteroscopic morcellation is similar or less. Continuous flow during the procedure keeps the image clear. Post-procedure contraction of the uterus stops most significant bleeding. Intrauterine pressure of the pump can be increased to help tamponade any oozing. Can anyone help me, please? So management of asymptomatic submucous myomas in women of reproductive age group, AAGL consensus, it says that asymptomatic myomas, if they are type A and B, has to be removed because it improves the pregnancy rates, that is type 0 and type 1. Medical therapy can be also combined. So other factors where you will have to, which factors will help you to predict the infertility is size of the myoma when it is above 3 centimeter, associated intramural component. When you have multiple things, you will have to plan your surgery accordingly. And the pregnancy rate in a woman after hysteroscopic myomectomy is 76.9%, and the miscarriage rate of after surgery is 26%. When you don't do a surgery, and the chances of miscarriage is really high, that is 62%. So the normal menstrual functions are actually restored after myomectomy. Intraoperative management of a uterine perforation, to scope or not to scope, critical observation is important. Most uterine perforations do not require treatment. Suction device is not useful. Electrosurgical energy source is not useful. Pelvic ultrasound for estimating intraperitoneal fluid can be used instead of scoping laparoscopically. Give very clear and specific discharge teaching and written instructions. Tell the patient there can be a serous discharge for 1 to 2 weeks, bloody discharge for 1 to 3 weeks. If she may feel cramps for at least 24 to 48 hours, should not intercourse for a week, and call if pain and fever persist. And you can really go and do a laparoscopy if the patient is not really stable. Intrauterine additions, symptomatic and asymptomatic grades, we have The risk factors main are miscarriage, curettage is done, which is 66%, followed by myomectomy. Multiple myomas, the chance of Escherman's is 45% and a single myoma is 31%, followed by the rest all procedures. So the risk factors are curettage after late miscarriages are the Escherman's is more compared to early miscarriages, and in late postpartum also, and repeated curettages also. So interventions most frequently associated with postoperative intrauterine additions are septoplasties, additional lysis, and myomectomies. So we will have to take care to prevent these Escherman's. So this is the classification systems, various things we have. Pointer set surgeries are planned in early proliferative phase. Explain need for second Ruleck because all the Escherman syndrome cases, we cannot clear the additions in a single setting, and use ostia as a guiding mark for how far and how lateral to go with. Consider USG and laparoscopy also in severe cavity obliterating additions. So recurrence rate, yes, up to 30% in mild to moderate and severe up to 60% cases. Pregnancy complications, ectopic miscarriages, and placenta previa, IUGR, and preterm birth. Hysteroscopic PRP, this we are doing for very thin endometrium, even also in Escherman cases where we are doing an extensive surgery, intrauterine additional analysis. For these people, we are doing hysteroscopic PRP. The PRP is at autologous blood plasma that has been enriched with platelets at about 4 to 5 times more than the circulating blood. As the procedure is not standardized, the method of preparing the PRP is not standardized. I'm not going into the depth of the preparation. This is the video. Unfortunately, the videos are not being played. Isthmocele repair. So this is a case of submucous myoma where this patient was actually operated hysteroscopically previously. To prevent adhesions, actually we have put an IUCD device. The second Ruleck is planned where the IUCD was in place, and we have removed the IUCD, and still this there are a few more submucous fibroids which need resection. So this is the video of the submucous myomas. So this is isthmocele. As Dr. Savita Madam said, how to repair a isthmocele laparoscopically. Not every patient will require a laparoscopic approach. It definitely depends upon the depth of the indentation of the defect of the caesarean scar. So this is how we measure a caesarean scar defect. These are various studies which said that, you know, how to identify the isthmocele, whether it is a single previous section or a two previous section, single layer or a double layer, it doesn't matter. And 2D on a 2D ultrasound only we can pick up. So on MRI very rarely, because we can pick it on 2D and 3D. Hysteroscopy, this is the hysteroscopic view, the anterior pouch like defect surrounded by fibrotic tissue. The fibrotic white tissue within and near the lesion can be removed with a resectoscope only. So depending upon the procedure done, these isthmocele repairs are named as isthmoplasty, isthmocele repairs. So plasties are just making the caesarean scar neat for a next embryo transfer. But if the defect is really more, the complete repair both hystero and laparoscopically should be included. So how long should you wait for subsequent fertility treatment after various hysteroscopic surgeries? So after polypectomy, 86% of the patients conceived within 1 month, and after myomectomy, 18% patients conceived, and after metroplasty, 19% conceived, and after additional lysis, if you do a proper additional lysis, 67% of the patients conceived within 1 month. So this is the time required for a patient to conceive after hysteroscopic procedure. Role of antibiotics, it is not proven. Anti-adhesive agents like hyaluronic acid and carboxymethyl cellulose, and mixture of hyaluron and carboxymethyl cellulose, all these things are available in the market. This is a biodegradable gel, mechanical barrier between the adjacent wound surfaces. It suppresses the formation of intrauterine adhesions, promotes healing, and remain in situ for 5 to 7 days. So the take home is careful case selection is of utmost importance. Checklist and SOPs is must to have in any endoscopic unit. Safety of patient is of utmost importance in fertility patients, dealing with fertility patients. Hysteroscopy can serve as third eye vision for all treating fertility physicians. Prevention and treatment of fluid deficit and its complications is important. Polyp needs excision and has good outcome. Proper diagnosis of septum is mandatory as its correction is warranted. Myoma has an effect on fertility and treatment should be offered in selected cases. Use of anti-adhesive agents, consider PRP for thin endometrium or the anti-adhesive gels when you go for a really rigorous procedures for adhesionolysis. Large isthmoseals needs correction. Small isthmoseals can be observed, but if the patient is not conceiving repeatedly and when you are planning a hysteroscopy for routine evaluation, this can be corrected. Don't forget to record and preserving your videos and records for all MLC purposes. Thank you for your patient hearing. I know everyone are really bored with my session maybe, but these I think this is what is being given for me and I have made my level best to put all the points. Thank you everyone.
Good evening everybody. My introduction is lengthier than is going to be my talk. So I'll limit my talk to few minutes only. I'm not going to deal with anything. Just I wanted to sum up the few things which have been taught to us till now. To start with the last slide of Dr. Durga Rao's, how many of you have observed? What was it? Just make whether you are alert or not. What was the last slide of Dr. Durga Rao's presentation? Pardon? I don't know. I am not very sure whether you are alert or not. There is an artificial womb was the last slide. If I am not wrong, madam. Yeah. So then comes to the myth and the fact. Is there any difference between the myth and the fact? Today's myth may be tomorrow's fact. With what authority you are calling it is, as far as this artificial womb is concerned, how many of you consider Mahabharata as mythology or an fact? How many of you consider Mahabharata? I think all of you know Mahabharata, I think, to an extent. How many of you consider it as a mythology? Mythology means it has been taught to us by the English people. It's a myth, isn't it? It's a study of myths. Do you think it's a mythology or as a fact? Then we considered it's a last slide of Dr. Durga Rao's madam's slide, which I'll elaborate a little bit. When Gandhari aborted and she was crying, so sought the help of Vedavyasa. Then he came, he divided the abortus fetus into 101. Good, very good. 101 pieces and kept them in the pots. Out of the 100 people, 100 were male, one was female. And all the 101 were genetically different because they have the different. They were different characters and they have the different temperament and everything, isn't it? Then coming to the need of the sperm. Do you really need sperm to impregnate a woman to have a child? Maybe today's knowledge says that yes, it's a must. It's a must, isn't it? Till later years, you know, go back to few years back, you know, conception for a conception, a woman has to have an intercourse. Otherwise, a woman cannot have a pregnancy. Now that myth has been shattered by madam, people like Durga Rao and Krishna sir. Tomorrow, I don't know, your younger generation, you are going to break this myth, saying that probably sperm may not be required to have a child. Maybe some technique which may manipulate the genetic material of any cell, what I am telling, any cell to produce a human being or a live birth. So there is little difference between a myth and the fact. Don't trust and give much importance when one says that it's a myth and someone says that it's a fact and the others is a wrong. So coming back to my topic, you know, I think I have bored you about telling this. This what is related. So technology both creates and destroys. It is true. It is an appropriate utilization or inappropriate utilization destroys and benefits us. Did you ever wonder why don't you get electrocuted with electrosurgery? Why don't we get electric shock when we use diathermy? Tell me anyone. Because this is a one which is really required because we are using it. We are using it. We are not electrical engineers. We haven't studied the electricity and to at a length except till 10th standard. Why? Yes. Is there a difference between electrosurgery and electrocautery? Do you believe? How many of you believe that there is a difference? All of?
Yeah.
What is coagulation and how does vessels seal? Which monopolar waveform is safer, whether it's a coagulating or the cutting? Then I will try to explain this. What are the traditional bipolars and the advanced bipolars which are available and how they are different? Why is lateral thermal damage is important for us? What energy modality produces more thermal energy and why? So basing on there are six things, I'll try to explain one after the other. What is the maximum vessel size you can coagulate with each modality? Of course, it's a simple thing. Then, what is the basics of surgery? What is the basics? Surgery means what? Cutting and cutting. Isn't it? It is cutting and controlling the bleeding. This is enough because where you have to cut, how you have to control the bleeding, you are a surgeon, isn't it? It is very simple to become a surgeon. It is very difficult to become an infertilologist or an andrologist because we have got only two things to do, cut and ligate. But the fundamentals of the surgery or as well as the sealing of the vessel, three things one has to remember. One is compression. And when you are using the energy, whatever the energy, it is converted into heat, isn't it? Then how much compression has to be applied, how much heat has to be generated, how much time you have to spend on that particular area or the vessel. These are the three things which you learned and you are going to be in a perfect surgeon as far as the modality electrosurgery is being involved. There are two types of energies used in the surgery. One is the electromagnetic energy or the electrosurgery, again being divided into monopolar and bipolar, and of course is the laser. Coming to the of late, for the last 15 odd years or so, we are using this mechanical energy, that is ultrasonic energy, besides suturing and the stapling. Suturing is and stapling is also is a mechanical energy which are mechanically occluding the part or the vessel or any tissue. Then coming to the difference between the cautery and the electrocautery and the electrosurgery and simple cautery. Simple cautery means just any metal or anything, you heat it and apply it onto the surface. That is anything which you foment onto the body, that is also is a cautery, isn't it? You are putting some fomentation onto your back. It is something called, otherwise is also called as a cautery. Electrosurgery is a process of, electrocautery is a process of destroying tissue with an object that is heated with electricity. That means a filament has to be there to heat the tip. So that heat is being transmitted to the tissue, isn't it? So here the current is not passing through the tissues. Current is passing through the filament. That filament is getting heated and that filament is touching the tissue. That is called electrocautery. I think how many of you are doing conization? So that is the loop which you are using is an electrocautery, isn't it? That's a filament we use for the conization of the cervix, is the filament which is heated up, isn't it? While when coning it, it comes off. So that is otherwise called as an electrocautery. Then the difference again is the electrosurgery. This is totally different because this uses an alternating current, which is which household current which we are using day in and day out, and pass through the patient to cut and coagulate the tissue. So we are passing the same alternate current through our body to create, generate cutting effect as well as the coagulating effect. It is almost like an electricity is like a double-edged knife. If you use it properly, it will save you, it will help you. If you don't use it properly, it destroys you. These are the few examples. Why don't patient get electrocuted or you don't get electric shock? Because as far as the frequency of the cycles is less than 60 hertz, the nerves will get the stimulation and there will be a jerk or shock. Suppose the frequency of the cycles, it's an alternative current, means it is going to and fro. So at what frequency it goes forward and comes back is the criteria. The number of cycles is the foremost important one. Suppose if you are using any electrode or that diathermy, patient gets in a shock, please think that there is something wrong with the diathermy because it is not giving sufficient cycles. That means it is not producing high frequency current. So that means it may be producing low frequency current, maybe patient getting electrocuted and she gets jerks. So please stop and you like. Another one, please check your pad, earth pad. Two things, don't proceed, don't ask your assistant to increase the voltage or increase the wattage or anything. Be careful whenever the patient gets in a shock like symptom on the table. So here our households electricity is around 60 to 100 cycles per second, whereas these generators will convert this low frequency electricity into multi-frequency electricity. That means it amplifies. So the generator which is there in the diathermy unit is amplifies the cycles. So that then what will happen? It amplifies to the extent of megahertz too, isn't it? So even it goes up to 60 megahertz, which is being used in the TVs and 500 to 1550 kilohertz, usually you will have the radio frequency, and 2000 to 3.3 megahertz usually we will use in the electric surgery. I think you have understood what the diathermy does. in a short, what it is doing? It is converting low frequency current into high frequency alternating current. Just simple word. This is the generator. How best that converts, how efficiently it converts into the high frequency current, and with the amplitude, everything will depends upon the your machine. So don't go for a cheaper machines which have got the generators which will go say that, you know, this gives higher 500 kilohertz frequency, but don't trust. Use it on a dummy, then make a decision. Because what will happen, most of the times what the manufacturers tell us, you know, it is not going to be there on the machines. They use the low converters, low frequency converters, but sell it to us. That's what majority of us have faced for the last few years. Then electricity. What is the electricity? It's a flow of electrons. What the electrons does, it selects the path of least resistance and the constant power variable voltage, and injury is proportional to the current density. So whenever there is any resistance, naturally the higher the voltage, it try to pass. Suppose if it won't pass, what will it does it? It takes a least resistant pathway. If you go on persisting on the area where it is not able to pass, what it does, it takes a least resistant pathway. There we are going to land up in problems. This is the principles of Ohm law, you know. I think we have read it in this thing. So power is voltage into current. This is simple. Just increase the power. That's what we do every time. Whenever it is bipolar is not working, it is not going, sir, can I increase up to 40 watts, isn't it? So we don't bother. Something must be wrong with your bipolar equipment itself. But without knowing it, we will try to increase the voltage of the machine, isn't it? There we will end up in problems. Because what will happen if you increase the voltage, what you are doing is, you are increasing the voltage. See, isn't it? So that increasing the voltage automatically increases the frequency of the cycles, and the voltage increases, it takes the least path. And as the voltage increases, there is an aura around the vessel, isn't it? Suppose if the high voltage wire is passing through your house, you can hear the sound, isn't it? But whereas in our house, we don't hear any sound, isn't it? Probably you may say that our wires are insulated. Even in an open wire, just like, you know, 220 volts wires, which is home supply, give any sound. Whereas the high voltage, 1100 kV voltage wires, which are there, you might have seen on the main roads, when you stand near them, you will hear a voice. What it is doing is, the aura around the vessels and the electrons are also flowing around the wires, which is creating an energy around these wires. So that energy, which is making the air to move and giving a sound, isn't it? So whenever you goes on increasing the voltage, so surrounding tissues also gets electrocuted. Then coming to the cutting and coagulation current. How many of you believe that which is dangerous? Cutting current is dangerous or the coagulation current is dangerous? Or otherwise I will put it. Which one is safer? Cutting current is safer or the coagulation current is safer? Why? Pardon? Yeah. See, what will happen? Say simple mechanism. Say cutting current is a low voltage current. high frequency. Whereas in the coagulation current, it is in a high voltage and low frequency. Simple, as good as this one. So cutting current always, it's a pure current. And how many of you believe that can you cut, can you coagulate with the cutting current? Isn't it? Yes, you can coagulate with the cutting current and you can cut with the coagulating current also. But the thing is, the element which you are using makes a difference. Suppose you have the blunt tip. In a cutting current, probably it will coagulate. It's the same coagulating current. If you are using with a sharp instrument, it cuts. And moreover, the cutting current is always produced as an arc. So with the arc, it goes on cuts. So the movement you put or goes near to the tissue and it creates an arc and goes on cutting. Because it's in a high frequency current, it spreads. And the low voltage, high frequency, it spreads. Whereas a coagulating current, it is in a high voltage current, low frequency, what will happen? You have to touch. You have to touch. Otherwise, it won't. Then actions of electrosurgery. Cutting is rapid tissue heating, explores the cells, and a constant duration. It is only monopolar. Of course, bipolar cutting is also is there. That's a different topic. Fulguration, sparks coagulate and char without cutting. So charring is very common when you try to fulgurate. It's only fulguration is only superficial. And it has to be applied for the short duration. And this is always, fulguration has to be with the high voltage current. Because when you use cutting current to fulgurate, usually you are ineffective because the moment you does it, it cuts. So you have to use fulgurate the superficial area. You have to use the coagulating current, but superficially, and short duration of time, only short duration. This is also monopolar, but desiccation heat is generated in the tissue as current passes, leading to coagulation. Low sparking, low power, this desiccation means it goes on doing it. As I told, tissue damage is proportional to the power applied to the area of contact. That's what I am telling. Suppose you goes on increasing the wattage, so you will be damaging the more tissues surrounding it. Ground pad failures, I think every one of us might have experienced this in our lifetime or might have seen it. What is the ideal pad? What is the surface area has to be with the contact with the pad? What's the area should be in contact with the pad? Can anyone tell? Maybe we are getting pads. Now we are getting that disposable pads. So imagine and tell, use your common sense, disposable pads of what size? Previously, we used to have the reusable pads, which is a big 1 foot length or somewhere in 14 inches to 12 inches or something like that. But now we are getting a disposable pads, which are as of how much? Approximately around 25 to 30 square centimeters area. This is a must. So earth pad has to be in touch with the body to an extent of 25 to 30 square centimeters. And where we have to put? Wherever there is a high vascularity. Most of the times, which one is the high vascular area? Is it the buttock? Is it the calf? Is the abdomen? Is it the upper arm? No, I'm not just that. Surface. You can't put to the brain, not to the scalp also, because hair is there. Where are you putting actually? Most of us, you may be using it, no? Day in and out. Huh? Is it right? Buttocks is the right? Buttocks is a lot of fat. It is a poor conductor of electricity. It is the ideal place to put the pad is the thigh, lateral part of the thigh. It is a thigh. Thigh has to be because hand. And moreover, as nearer to the site of surgery as possible. Suppose you are doing surgery in the abdomen, the ideal is keep the pad on to the thigh, anterior aspect or the lateral aspect of the thigh, where the vascularity is more, where there is a less fat, and the conduction or the exit current will pass quickly, you won't get any increased resistance. Why charring is more when we use monopolar is another reason, is this one also. When current is passing fast, there is no resistance, usually it will coagulate. Once the resistance is there, it burns. So always keep this in mind. From tomorrow onwards, please use disposable earth pads, which has to be kept onto the thigh, lateral aspect of the thigh, as nearer to your site of surgery. These are the instruments and current concentrations. Then function of variable resistance of tissues, function of desiccation, function of current. This image, I think the 20 watt current, it is very minimal. The gallbladder, there is an adhesion, there is around a bowel. What's happening? You are cutting the desiccation, adhesion. So you are trying to cut it. So what is happening is, these adhesions are most of the times fibrotic. Most of the times fibrotic. So when you are using any current, coagulating or cutting current, when it is not passing through it properly, there is an increased resistance. Then there is a flow of electrons beyond or around the electrode. So what will happen? The gallbladder. Gallbladder is a very thick, isn't it? So conduction through the gallbladder is limited, is the least resistant when compared to the bowel. Two are at equal distance. One is highly conductive substance, another is a low, high resistance subject. Suppose if it is an electricity is generated in that with the voltage, it takes a least path, least resistant path. So bowel will burn instead of the gallbladder. Why it hasn't chosen? It should have gone equally. Equal amount to the bowel, equal amount to the bladder, because it is in equidistance, isn't it? But it won't. Because once the electricity generated, it takes a least resistance path. Once goes on to the bowel, it goes that way only. It never goes towards the bladder, the high resistance tissue. That's the reason when you are very close to the least resistant tissues, you have to be very, very far away, isn't it? So when you are operating in the pelvis, especially around the ureter, so you have to be close to the uterus. Uterus has got a high resistance, isn't it? But whereas the ureters have got the least resistance, where water is flowing. So whenever in the deviated current, it passes through the least resistance. So what I mean to say, don't estimate that you are far away from it. Whenever a soft tissue is there, be careful, and it should be very, very far away. At least 1.1 to 1.5 centimeters away from the bowel is ideal when you use especially monopolar current. Especially mono. Bipolar current, it's okay, because it goes prongs, in between the prongs. Then potential risks of monopolar electrosurgery. What is the direct coupling and capacitative? Should I detail it, or you might have gone through it? I think I will skip this one. Then I will. Just to make you understand one this thing, because what usually our theater boys, you know, just they coil all the cables around our instruments because they won't fall off, isn't it? They'll pull through the towel clips. They will twist it around the trocar. Especially in a laparoscopy, they'll twist it around the trocar. What will happen when you twist an electrical circuit, when you make a circuit, usually there will be current will be generated in that circuit, and it will. There is an experiment, but it's a normal tube. It is not being connected to any positive or negative. Just you have wound an electrical wire to a tube, and you try to pass current through it, the tube lights. So this is what happens. This is otherwise also is called the coupling current. You don't know how that current has passed through that instrument, because you have wound the electrical wire to an element. So suppose if you have wound in a metal trocar and you have done electric surgery, that trocar gets the electrical energy, and wherever the trocar goes and touches, it burns. So never and ever own the electrical, cautery wires against any of the instruments. That's a takeaway message. And the single site surgery is one of the disadvantages of the single site surgery is that, you know, when they use it, there's a coupling current, and this instruments, wherever they go, they touch it, they have caused injuries. So that's one of the disadvantages of single site surgery, single port surgery, is coupling current. Then bipolar current I explained. What is the monopolar I explained. Bipolar is nothing but the current passes through the two elements and it goes back to the generator itself, comes to the body, to the tape, and passes to the body, and again gets back to the generator, and it is not going to pass through the body of the patient, isn't it? Only tissue is being exposed at this. But whereas in a monopolar current is, please remember, current is passing through the whole of our body. But whereas a bipolar, it is passing through the tissues which you have held and going back to the generator, isn't it? But the thing is, please remember, whatever you are using, whatever the method of bipolar or the, please use pad, earth pad, because sometimes even bipolar fails, and if it acts like a monopolar, you are saved.